Oh, hi there.
Hello.
I'm Tom Killock, and this is Francis Cowper.
Hello. Welcome to Dark Sphere.
Welcome to Dark Sphere, yeah. And it looks like you can hear us. Wonderful.
So our players are just sitting down. We have Adrian from last week, the Elves Master with the Foil Elves deck, and last week's champion, Patrick, with Sylvan Quinn. Is that a fan favorite?
Well, he went 4-0 last week, so hopefully... we can see his deck and why it's so good for FNM, at least.
I hope you all pick up your Rest in Pieces and Helm of Obediences, because Sylvan Quinn is coming for you.
It's a reserve list card. So I think we're about ready to start. Looks like the scorekeeper's going over to the table. So let's move over and have a little talk about the decks. Ah, there, they're shuffling, wonderful.
Oh, right, very nice.
So Patrick's on the left, obviously, Adrian on the right. Adrian's Elves deck is fully foil, but I don't know what he prefers. If he prefers the grindy version with some Nissas in the main, or if he likes to play a version more combo focused with Natural Order and things like that.
I think I have seen him cast Nissa before.
But
yeah, but he might change it up. Might be difficult to get all those foils. We can see an Isochron Scepter, a Snow-Covered Plains, a Windswept Heath, and an Oblivion Ring, a Source of Plowshares, and a Snow-Covered Forest in Patrick's hand.
Would you keep this against Elves?
Yeah, the Source of Plowshares.
Probably would, yeah.
Seems acceptable.
He's got
Patrick being very helpful.
Isochron Ring. Sorry, his Scepter and his Oblivion Ring.
His lands and interaction. Adrian choosing to mulligan the hand that he didn't quite show us there.
Yeah.
but I'm sure that he knows what he's doing. I'm not sure if any sort of destroy target artifact effects will come up with his foil cards like they might have done last week.
Well, there should be a main deck Reclamation Sage.
All right.
That's kind of Elves staple these days. I know this because I had to lend an Elves deck to someone today. I had to find other cards.
More than one Elves player in a field of some players.
I think we have 23 or 4 players today. So
pretty
standard.
That looks about right, yes. Right, Adrian drawing his hand.
There's a Wildwood Symbiote there, I see. And Birchlore on the top. That looks like...
No lands?
Is that Quirion Ranger?
He's
though?
On 5 already as well.
Oh, he's already on 5.
He has no lands on 5.
Well, this is going to be a quick game.
Not looking great here. He's going
and
to
down to
4.
Elves can win on 4, I think, though. Especially against a slow deck like Patrick's.
If you have, a Glimpse or a Natural Order or something,
yeah,
you might.
Yeah.
Yeah. Patrick does have that Source to Plowshares, though, which...
Well, knowing his hand, I think we can... I would put my money on Patrick to win this one. But...
Maybe. Also, Elves doesn't play very many lands, and some of the lands don't make any mana. So
yeah,
on turn one, at least.
Yeah, 4 of them, yeah.
So, yeah. And also, Dryad Arbor isn't particularly good immediately. Especially against Source of Plashes, so...
But it's 20 lands, and I'm counting Dryad Arbor there as a creature.
Okay. I still think this is a little bit awkward, but a Craterhoof Behemoth in the 4 cards in the opener. Again, no land.
All right, I think this is a bit of a non-game here.
Would Symbiote, Reclamation Sage, Craterhoof Behemoth, and is that a Deathrite Shaman?
Should we get up some of the...
I'm not sure what that was.
...card images that we know are in the deck here.
Oh, no. What? Oh, he's drawn for his turn. Okay. So, Patrick has his turn 2 Sylvan Library, namesake of the Sylvan Quinn deck.
Is this how one spells Isochron Scepter? Evidently not.
No, it's an American spelling.
What do you mean it's American spelling?
It's like this.
Oh my god, really?
Yes.
No, it's not worked. Safe?
Very odd.
Oh, you're right.
Yes.
So that's not how you spell Scepter. It should be RE.
Magic is an American game. Okay, well... Patrick
Orange.
Is going to make sure that... Okay, and that's a concession.
And that's going on. So
fair enough. Adrian can't play any spells following...
If you didn't quite see, maybe I'll let you type, I think. There was an Orim's Chant there on Isochron Scepter. And that means that Patrick can't play any spells. Can't attack.
Preventing Adrian from attacking or casting spells... for the rest of the game, unless there's some sort of abrupt decay, I suppose. Patrick thinking about his sideboarding. What might Patrick want to bring in against Elves?
I think he's got some sideboard humilities.
Okay.
So I'd bring those in.
So you'd make all the 1/1s into 1/1s.
Well,
very interesting.
It turns off Heritage Druid. It turns off Deathrite. It turns off all of the things that give them a mana advantage.
Okay.
What else would I from his sideboard? I think we can't really see there.
Patrick cutting Abeyance. Interesting.
that card that I've already forgotten what it does.
Okay, well, come on. It's a two mana instant that prevents your opponent casting instant sorcery activating abilities, I believe.
Yes,
and then you draw,
and
a, card.
A card as well, don't you? Yes. Yeah. So I have to press
save. Drawing cards is great.
There we are.
And interrupts, if that's ever relevant.
Unfortunately, it isn't anymore. What would Adrian be bringing in? It's some Abrupt Decays, I suspect.
Decay seems good against the Isochron Scepter.
He's seen that, hasn't he?
Thing lock.
He must know what's going on.
It probably kills
as well.
Rest in Peace, stops Helm of Obedience, yeah. Killing you there, sort of.
I think his deck is just consistently faster and probably better at beating down through all the backups of things like Ensnaring Bridge that Patrick's going to have. So.
I would expect him to be able to answer things like Ensnaring Bridge and the combo.
Yeah.
Especially post-build with Decay in his deck. So, there shouldn't be a problem there. It's unfortunate that he mulliganed several hands with no lands in, essentially not getting to play a game.
And Patrick was so upset about last week not being on the stream.
I know, he was.
And here he
4-0,
is.
And now he's just going to win again.
Showing
5-0.
Showing the power of his deck to make the opponent... Completely, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Maybe that's the real power. Patrick just is excellent at making his opponent have no lands in their opening hand. And that's a very good way of going 4-0. Not that I have much experience of that. but
no, you're a miracles master on the
I didn't write that description of myself.
No, I did. I thought it was very appropriate. Yes. I looked at how many 5-0s you've got. You've got plenty.
I have several.
Yeah, it all comes on NTG Goldfish.
I mean, anyone's allowed to play on Magic Online. So, not sure. But yeah.
You can't win by your opponent playing very... Well, I suppose you can win by your opponent playing badly, but you can't win by your opponent giving themselves deck game losses and things like that, like you can in real life.
No, it's quite difficult to get disqualified online. But
a few players have, though, haven't they?
Have they?
I think trading cards or having two accounts.
Oh, those
like
things.
That. Yeah.
Bribery.
Being banned. Yes, bribery. Yeah. God, there's quite a few ways.
Yes,
don't
well,
do any of these things.
Yeah, it's casting bribery online. Terrible idea. Your opponent never has anything good to get anyway. Their deck, so wouldn't worry about that. Okay, our opponents are now shuffling up for their second game, I suppose.
Oh, yes, we need to change that Patrick's won a game. Thanks for reminding
Patrick
us.
Patrick has won a game. I'm very sorry. We're all too new to this.
I mean, yeah, that game was so quick, they could be playing round
there
one.
There we go. Patrick, game one. Very exciting. Now it's completely clear. I can't actually see the chat currently.
No,
me
neither.
Is there any way of doing this?
Shall I try and find that?
That would be good. I mean, I could get it up on my phone.
That's what I was going to considering. Let's do it on your phone, because there's quite a lot going on the screen
okay,
here. And then we can sort it out for round two, so we can interact. Do you think the Cyborg Humilities are going to be too slow here?
Yes.
in a word.
I've actually discussed this deck with Patrick quite a lot since a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah.
And I keep thinking it'd probably be quite good having Ancient Tomb in his deck full of 4-mana enchantments. However,
that's a fair point. But he wants to use Scrying Sheets, which we should bring up here.
Of course. Our turn one, Deathrite Shaman. Popular opener for many a deck in Legacy.
He wants to use Scrying Sheets to gain value. As usual, I spot this completely wrong. Oh, no. Well,
no,
there we
got it correct. Well done.
He's going to find his basics, which are all snow lands with Scrying Sheets, and he won't be able to get Ancient Tombs with that.
Well, no, but I... What are the requirements? Oh, the top card must be a snow land.
Yeah.
Well...
I thought you weren't a fan of the Ancient Tomb.
Oh, I don't like
that. We certainly had
I don't enjoy the card very often. It's often pretty good against what I'm trying to do. But, whatever. Somebody is saying, Humility incoming. I think the deck is known as Parfait. Parfait is a different deck, as I'm sure Patrick will tell you. Parfait
yes.
is a deck involving, I believe, Lantax and Scrollrack, which is a different deck. Quinn was a deck involving Sensei's Divining Top, and
I think the Mighty Quinn is no.
I think
there's a song called the Mighty Quinn, isn't there? That's what the deck
Legacy deck
to be
nomenclature
after.
Doesn't necessarily make entire sense. So Adrian has thought seized Patrick taking his Humility. So maybe Adrian is worried about Humility, or maybe he
outgoing.
Just doesn't care about the other cards.
Well, there's a Phyrexian Revoker there. I'm surprised he didn't take that. I would be under the impression that you could win before he plays Humility. but Phyrexian Revoke is going to slow you down.
Well, that.
Or stop your Death Rite working to slow you down enough. How would you value that?
That might be telling us something about Adrian's hand. Abrupt Decay. Or his hand is not prepped to kill immediately, and maybe he's sort of in it for the long game.
Okay, so that's how you would...
Well, it's one or the other. Yeah. I don't... It's difficult to see.
It's unlikely to be a mistake, though. Adrian's very good at death.
Adrian knows what he's doing. I mean, he spent all his money on these shiny bits of metal, so...
It's good that... Their glare is not ruining them either, isn't it? We can actually see what's going on.
I'm not sure what's happened this week.
This does look like a grindy opening.
Yeah, Elvish Visionary and Deathrite Shaman. I mean, he could still probably just win the game next turn.
Well, he attacked for one as well, though.
The hidden seventh mode on Deathrite Shaman.
So, Patrick should be on 19, I think.
Yes.
And he's not played the Revoker out there naming Deathrite.
No, so he's holding up mana to cast Enlightened Tutor?
Yeah.
What would you go and get for turn three?
See, I would play the Revoker now and then play the Enlightened Tutor for the turn four Humility so I can't get it lost from my hand.
Maybe. But does Patrick have two Humilities in his 75?
I think he has, yes, I think he has two in the sideboard.
I don't know then.
What's the turn three enchantment that he wants?
I'm trying to think. Definitely not choke, is it?
No. Are there artifacts he's after? Is there a Sylvan Library or maybe a Snaring Bridge he's thinking? Snaring Bridge doesn't do anything here either.
Well, Enlightened should take his card out of his hand. You play a land. Maybe Bridge does something in two turns?
Possibly, yeah.
Well, then you would play Revoker this turn anyway.
I think so, yeah.
Maybe he was waiting to see something else he preferred to name, like Wyrewood Symbiote.
Well, that is a better name, probably, than Deathrite at this point, because you can bounce the Elvish Visionary in your turn and in the next turn.
We're being informed that Adrian spent 3 mana casting Thoughtseize on that turn. Sorry if we missed that.
Did he? Well, the graveyard's gone, so it's quite hard to see.
Yeah, so we can't quite see the top half of the screen for us.
Oh, no, we move this down here, and we can see more. Yeah. But the graveyards are still not there.
Yeah.
Didn't he lead with a turn 1 Thoughtseize? No, it was turn 1 Deathrite.
So he didn't cast Enlightened Tutor, and he played Phyrexian Revoker the next turn. I'm not sure what Patrick's doing.
Well, obviously he was leaving it to go to name the symbiote. He wasn't scared of the fast opening hand.
Of the shaman.
Probably, because he took the humility. Adrian took the humility. So he's thinking...
Maybe.
I mean, is that far too next level?
That's are we assuming? Pretty high level thinking. Maybe I suppose he's the Quinn expert.
He's the reigning Darksphere
champion. Patrick is he's the reigning Darksphere champion, but he's also one of the sole members who regularly updates the source thread on Quinn.
Yes.
Patrick is in fact kinda on the source. So if you check out that thread at any point, you will see his name repeatedly. So
Patrick always brings an odd deck.
Yes, you could say this.
I think we've worked out what's going on. I've worked out what's going on. He's left up the mana for Enlightened Tutor and Orange Chant or every turn, and we've missed that because we have
He could have stopped Adrian attacking.
Yeah, or a turn 3 combo win.
Yes, of course.
But
I'm just not familiar with the lines revolving around Orym's Chant. That might be my problem.
But naming the Deathrite would have stopped the lines around Orym's Chant as well. I'd rather this was more predictive. I didn't have to.
Oh right, you'd rather had fuzzy matching on the scoreboard assistant.
Yes, I should really have to put an apostrophe in, or.
Well, you know.
Do you know what's going? There's going to be a moment where Myth Realized comes up, and I spend 10 minutes complaining about the spelling of
Zed. Yeah.
Realized.
Okay. Right, Reclamation Sage has entered the battlefield, destroying Phyrexian Revoker. So there's Adrian's answer.
I mean, this game is going quite firmly in Adrian's favour.
I think Adrian might well be. Winning,
but if this Enlightened Tutor gets something that locks him out right now, you know, like a second ability, then this game is we're back on.
I mean,
because here is the turn three.
Looks like he's looking at Bridge. not quite sure. Now he's moved his deck off the camera, so it's difficult to tell what he's tutoring for. We will see it in a moment.
He will have also brought in
got a second humility. And Adrian is now probably feeling a bit sad. He's used.
He's going to get the bounce off the symbiote in Patrick's turn. So he's going to cast the Sage, and he's going to kill the humility.
I don't know if that works.
No, good point.
He's revealing his... he's cracking the fetch line. He might cast humility this turn.
Bum, bum, bum!
Okay, he's looking at that snow-covered plains. That is a snowland. Oh, he's going for the snow-covered forest, which is also a snowland. I don't think that there are any snow creatures in Patrick's deck today, but...
What other snow permanents are there? I wasn't playing at the Cold Snap.
You can play an
area.
Oran Viper is a snow creature.
That is the famous one, isn't it? And
Glacial Worm, which is the one that doesn't work on Magic Online.
That breaks the internet. Yeah.
Yes. But last week, Patrick was playing it. Not last week, but at the Grand Prix London, Patrick was playing an Oran Viper black-green deck.
Oh, wonderful. So we can see here that Adrian obviously...
Adrian is playing all his one mana 1/1s.
Well, he didn't bounce the Reclassation Sage, so he obviously
knows that doesn't work. So Adrian's plan is now to attack with his 7 1/1s, which is quite reasonable. Patrick is dead in 2 turns still, and he has two cards in hand. He's dead in three turns. Three turns. If that other card is Helm of Obedience, though, we might have an awkward moment. Oh, Patrick's untapping his lands. What? Whose turn is it? Is he not attacking? Oh, right. Okay. He's preventing Adrian from attacking. I'm a little confused what's going on here.
Whose turn is this?
I'm not actually sure whose turn.
Well, Patrick untapped, so it must be Patrick's turn. Beginning his turn.
Why didn't Adrian attack? Am I missing something here?
Oh, no. He said stop before attacks, perhaps?
But then he untapped his mana that he'd already used to cast Rest in Peace. Mm. What's he doing?
He said go.
I don't understand, really.
No, me neither. Your Rest in Peace means your Orange Chance, and it's great. Did he pay the kicker? He paid the kicker cost.
Yes. I don't quite understand what is going on here. Right.
So we're making sure all the mana's tapped. So Rest in Peace mana's tapped, and...
So you can't cast spells.
Yes. So the mana from Rest in Peace was still tapped, and the mana from...
Okay.
Orange Chant with the kicker was still tapped. Looks so just double-checking he had all the white, I think. He's still not dead, though. He's got two turns.
He has an Enlightened Tutor in hand.
Why is he not...
He could have cast that last turn, right?
This is the turn.
What's that? Verexion Revoker.
That's a 1/1.
So if he can live another turn, then he can go and get Helm of Obedience.
Well, he must get it at the end of this turn and win the next.
I'm a little confused. So he has 1-3 white mana to cast Rest in Peace and Orym's Chant kicked, I suppose. Yes.
So how much damage is this? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it looks like Patrick's got this if he can remember to...
I'm not sure why he paid the kicker cost on Orym's Chant last turn.
Because it means they can't attack.
But he could have cast Orym's Chant for one white and Rest in Peace for another white and a green.
Yeah.
And then he wouldn't be able to play spells. He would have taken 7 and then he could have Enlightened Tutor for Helm of Obedience and killed his opponent.
Could have, yes. And he's playing it very, very safe. Or he wanted to use all the cards in his hand.
Okay.
The perfect win.
I suppose so, in some sense. Some people think that the perfect win is where your opponent has no permanents and no cards in hand.
I would subscribe to that view as well.
As the lands player.
There we are.
Ooh. Showing some information there. Patrick has Source to Pleasures in his deck post-board.
Main deck as well. In the funnily enough, the white deck, which doesn't run any creatures and dies to aggressive strategies, will be running a...
No, they need to update the scores.
Yeah. Maybe that'll be nice.
Oh, he drew Helm off the top. Interesting. I think he did Enlightened Tutor for it, though.
Yes, of course he did, yeah. He had Enlightened Tutor in hand.
Yes.
So I'll find out if we're having another game or not.
Right. Patrick is done.
We're getting set up for another one, so we'll come back to the booth.
Let's go back to the booth.
And we'll just... booth? Here we are. Ah, you see our face is gigantic. And hopefully we'll get passed over what we're playing next. Any questions in chat about that wonderful deck? Should I try and
Other than the question
up?
About Parfait, there have been no questions so far. If anyone does have any inquiries about things such as Sylvan Quinn or elves...
Or miracles. Francis is known miracles.
You can ask about miracles.
Master.
Right. You can ask about those things. Those are things that are fine. You could ask me about miracles. That would change this dynamic of this stream quite a lot, I suspect.
Well, it'll be a very long stream where we're going to talk for a long time. I know a bit about lands. Hopefully, we're going to get some lands.
Oh, apparently my colleague at work has been watching this stream.
Oh, wonderful. Is he enjoying it?
She hasn't said whether she's enjoying it or not. Shout out to Jessica.
Hello, Jessica. Do you like magic a lot?
I don't think she quite knows how magic works, but it's all right.
Well, I'm sure they're enjoying our
That's moderately enjoyable. No, we are not serving cards.
Who are we getting on stream?
I'm not sure what's going on. We're supposed to be having another match on stream.
It looks like our other Patrick is going to be on the stream.
Is anyone?
Just one second. Are we having anyone else?
I'm seeing if I can get anyone else who's going into Game 3.
Okay.
We're looking for someone going into Game 3. Legacy is a fast format this evening, and most people are going to try talking to Callum. Callum's playing a slow deck.
He's playing
against Claude.
Claude will not want to go on stream because he is super stressed.
Why?
Well, he's playing elves for the first time ever.
It's not very stressful. Play creatures in the deck.
It's surprisingly awkward to play that deck.
Yes, it's pretty complicated.
And against the main deck Terminus deck, I'm probably not having the best of times.
Well, Callum's not playing Miracles.
But he's playing something involving unexpectedly absent.
Callum is playing
Terminus.
4 Predict and 2 copies of the card Foreshadow, which I'm going to get up.
Yes, I think you should. Yeah. Oh, no, they can't see it here.
Oh, right.
Okay, we'll have another game.
We're going to the B-Right back screen.
We're going to the B-Right back
screen. As you might have just heard. We'll see you soon.
See you in a second. Bye.
All right, everybody, welcome back. We have, in fact, got another match for you live here today. We're going to have Punishing Deck versus Waterfalls. everybody loves Deathrite Shaman and multicolor midrange decks.
Well, it's not really a midrange deck. It's a wonderful
concoction of Cascade.
Value deck, I suppose, isn't it? Let's go to the game table and see if we started.
Oh, right. Here we are. Oh, yes. Excellent. So
we should get up the most important card in Waterfalls. You've chosen the correct one. Bloodbraid Elf.
Here it is. Hello.
Bloodbraid.
Is it coming? There we are.
There we are.
Bloodbraid Elf. So some of you may remember this card from your nightmares. It attacks you and casts something like a Himstruck or an Ancestral Vision or, in this deck, a Shardless Agent.
Well, classically, this was a Blightning that would come off this.
Blightning or Maelstrom Pulse.
Yeah, mostly Blightning, maybe a Putrid Leech.
So if you had an empty hand, they hit Maelstrom Pulse. And if you had your Jace, they hit Blightning.
Or Lightning Bolt. That was in the standard at that time as well.
Yeah, Lightning Bolt, Bloodbraid Elf, Jace, Blightning. These are all fair Magic cards.
Did you play standard at the point when Bloodbraid Elf was a card?
I didn't.
I did. I enjoyed playing the Liliana's Caress deck.
With Megrim. Don't know what that does. I know what Megrim is.
It had Megrim and a cheaper Megrim, Blightning,
right.
Lightning Bolt, and the one mana card that says draw three, discard three.
That's a But
both players do it.
Sure, Burning Inquiry.
Burning Inquiry, yeah.
Right.
So everybody was
very entertaining. I'm sure that everybody loved playing Magic with you back in 2010.
I think it even won Finnish Nationals, and that's how I found the deck list. It was quite exciting.
Well, our players are still shuffling up.
Diego is playing Punishing Dak.
As you saw last week.
Okay, he
was on stream versus Adrian, who was on our stream. There are other people who do play here. We're not lying. There are 20-something people here. But it just so happens that the same people have been put on round again. Maybe they're fan favorites already.
So the Waterfalls deck looks like some kind of Blue Giant. Yes, that's very much like it. But it's everything is value. So you cascade from Bloodbraid Elf into Shardless Agent, which then will probably cascade again into a Baleful Strix, which will probably draw you a one-mana spell that you really want. Or you might even cascade into an Ancestral Visions, and you've just splurged all over the board and drawn far too many cards. And then you can Abrupt Decay something and attack.
Yep.
Oh, Alexi's arms on stream here.
Alexi is...
Was that a game already?
They're in game three.
No, it was game one. Still game two.
Of course it is. Mid-range mirror. Takes a million years.
Yeah, and these players like to shuffle.
They've been shuffling for a good while. We're starting. Swamp, Thoughtseize, and seven cards in hand for Diego. Jace, Ponder, Decay, Delta, Fire, Underground Sea, and Colligan's Command.
This is a great hand.
It is.
He's got three answers against the creatures that are going to come down from Daniela.
Daniel has Island, Delta, I believe, Brainstorm, Toxic Deluge, and Leovold. Yeah. So none of those removal spells are actually very good against Leovold, especially now that Decay is gone.
He's taken the best one there.
And he is on the play, so... Oh, well, there's a Thoughtseize off the top for Diego.
He does that often. Honestly,
draws Thoughtseize on turn one.
Yeah, every time I've played against him, he's Thoughtseizes me in the...
Even when he's playing Sneaking Show.
It's very upsetting.
Mokayak, I'm very sorry. We could have a player interview with Patrick. I'm not sure. I'm sorry he didn't tell you that he was on stream. You didn't really miss him, but he did handily crush elves in round one. Sorry, Adrian.
This will be on YouTube, so you can.
This will be on YouTube. It will probably be on Twitch videos as well. Somewhere. Yeah. All right. Daniel is cracking his Polluted Delta, going for what would you guess?
This is a four-color deck. I wasn't going to guess
Island.
That one.
Can we get him on stream again? Probably not. We'd like to show a variety of decks this evening. Sylvan Quinn, whilst lovely, is not something you want every round.
I'd like to see some of the matchups where he actually has to play against a deck that interacts with him.
True. Brainstorm.
That'd be interesting to see.
From Daniela.
But
he's drawing Thoughtseize, Pyroblast, and what is that? Is that a Putrid Leech?
Well, that'd be awesome if it was, but no.
No, it's not.
Is it a promo card that I have
is
no idea?
Abrupt Decay or a
Golgari Charm, perhaps?
Maybe. We'll find out, I suppose.
Why would you have a Golgari Charm?
Thoughtseize.
It won't be a Golgari Charm.
Unfortunately, he can't take the land here, but What do you think he's going to go for?
I'd probably take the ponder at this point.
I agree. I would go for ponder here. And Daniel agrees. Wow. Unanimous decision.
Let's be very, very honest about this. That's the correct choice.
Well, I don't know. He might not have an answer to Jace. I mean, he does, but we'll see. Okay, right. So the Leovold, I believe, got taken.
Yeah, he lost his answer to Jace.
Well, he has a blast, but he doesn't have a red source. No. So Jace may end up just winning this game. There is a reason to take. He knew he couldn't kill Jace in the top two cards, and if Diego draws any lands.
Well, no, he shuffled off the Brainstorm, didn't he? So.
Oh, and he doesn't have any lands.
No, he's drawn another Toxic Deluge. Oh, right. This isn't good.
Well, Diego is probably quite frustrated now that his deck is not cooperating. Oh, he drew a Brainstorm.
Well, I'm more worried about Daniello at the moment. He can't kill the Jace.
Well, the Jace, Diego has no lands and only has two lands in play.
But he's got cards that do things. Punishing Fire kills something that Daniello does.
True.
He's got the Jace, the inevitability of that, you know.
He did find a land on Leovold. Looks like a Surgical? I'm not sure. Maybe two Surgicals. There are two cards that are the same in that
would
hand.
Would you bring in Surgical here?
I mean, I wouldn't, but lots of people like Surgical. He's putting back Force of Will. It seems suspicious when you're up on cards probably because you can't play your lands and your opponent has lots of mana.
Well, your opponent is not playing a counters deck, though. Waterfalls is unlikely to have cards that other than Force of Will that you...
Oh, there were Baleful Strixes, not Surgicals. That makes more sense.
Is it Baleful Strix?
He has two Strixes, I think a Leovold, a Jace.
Wait, are we talking about Diego, sorry?
Yes, Diego's going to play Baleful Strix here. That makes sense. Find a fetch land, he's going to fetch, play a Baleful Strix.
But let's talk about why he'd put the Force back. Your opponent's playing a deck that you what's the point in forcing something that's going to cascade?
Yes, well, that is true. But he might play something like a Leovold or a Jace, and that would be unfortunate.
You have your answer, you know, don't you? You have your own Jace?
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I think it's worth considering. But
I think that the fact that Danielle has not done anything for four, five turns now.
Okay. Yes,
leaves you to say...
His Brainstorm rather messed him up. Oh, another Brainstorm.
Okay.
What's the chances of this resolving? Pretty high.
Oh, he's got a Surgical in his
He has got
well.
A Surgical. They've both got Surgicals.
That's very odd.
I thought he might have a Surgical. I don't know why Diego has Surgical. Maybe Danielle also has Punishing Fire, Grove of the Bimworlds in his deck.
That's super greedy.
He now has access to red mana, so he can counter the Jace, which...
Well, we hope, unless he's only got Volcanic Islands in his deck. That's a Verdant Catacombs.
That seems greedy.
Do you think you might have a Badlands?
I would have a Badlands in this deck. Again, I don't tend to play these sorts of decks, maybe I wouldn't know. None of these cards say Source of Plashes or Tundra, so...
You're not a one-trick pony. There's Wasteland as well. This deck is super greedy.
It has a Badlands.
There we go. The Badlands, yeah.
Seems pretty bad. Going for it anyway.
I can't believe he's running Wasteland as well.
And Basics. He's running Wasteland, Basics, and four colors. Wow. It's a Bloodbraid Elf. That's what that card is.
Oh, it's the awful modern art of Bloodbraid Elf.
Whoa. Art is subjective.
No, it's the awful... And he's got Punishing Fires as well. That's the Grove of the Bermudas.
Oh, yeah, Shardless Agent.
Oh, here we go. We're doing it.
Bloodbraid Elf into Shardless Agent.
Keep going. And the Brainstorm's coming as well.
Not quite Ancestral Vision.
Oh, that would have been lovely.
Unfortunately, though, he only gets to cast Brainstorm.
There's a Goyf as well. God, this deck really is full
Daniel
on.
Is properly going for it here on the greed level.
What's your favourite card ever printed? Oh, I can't decide. I'm going to play them all.
Yeah. And getting in for 3 damage.
I'm glad to see Bloodbraid Elf back. Yes. Patters UK. Yeah, Waterfalls is a cascade deck because, you know, Waterfalls cascading down. I suppose that's the... perhaps should have explained
again,
that.
Again, another legacy deck name, much like Sylvan Quinn, that doesn't really mean anything.
No, this one has a certain...
I suppose this means slightly more. Danielle showing us off his graveyard. Look at all those Brainstorms he's cast.
Yeah. He had a free one, remember?
Well.
So would you keep the him here? What's your plan?
Against
really?
Diego.
I mean, I suppose...
I mean, he has a lot of cards in hand.
Are you the aggressor here? Are you thinking of blasting the
No.
The Strix, just getting in for five, ending the game nice and quickly. You've got the Surgical, you put back on top for
bold
punishing fires.
Bold strategy, Cotton. Thank you, Patters. Toxic Deluge.
I just don't know how to...
I mean, he's not really...
To, like, function.
He's just down a card now. I'm a little uncertain of what's going on here.
Is the metric of who's winning this game just who has more number of cards in hand, basically?
That's all Magic. Is anyone playing something super spicy? Callum Whitefaces Smith is playing with the card Foreshadow in his deck this evening.
It's not quite the poor man's predict, but the other it's
one in a blue.
Okay.
Target your opponent only. If you name the card correctly, you draw two cards and
but
it mills.
You've portented and maybe you looked at their top cards and
he's playing three unexpectedly absent. Hymn to Turok takes away Surgical Extraction, which is not really a card anyway, and Leovold, so that's great.
What do you think? Do you think
Tarmogoyf?
Surgical
is
the wrong
big.
Card here to bring in?
I
think it is.
I'm not sure.
Why is he rearranging his graveyard now?
Punishing Jund with blue, playing Punishing Check Pile. So this is Waterfalls versus a Dak Faden deck.
Yes, it's called Punishing Dak, yes. So
it's based on you discard your Punishing Fires, rather, to your Dak Faden.
Yep.
And then you return them to your hand, and that allows you to Dak Faden again, so it turns Dak into pure card advantage.
There's a lot of value.
Cracky Callum is playing four Predict and two Foreshadow. Callum likes drawing cards.
There's a lot of... it's the understatement of...
Callum is a big fan of drawing cards.
Well, is he going to draw more cards than... Well, he's going to draw more cards than Daniel, but he's going to get more cards in left in his hand.
I don't know. Right, what's going on? So Diego's drawn a card for his turn.
So we've got Leovold, Colligan's Command, and the Jace is still there.
In his hand?
Polluted Delta? It's hard to see.
No, I think you were right. I can't have too many more Polluted Deltas in his deck. So this is a Leovold, or...?
No, this is a Colligan.
No, this is a Jace. This is a Jace.
Is this the Jace?
He's just working out what to use for his fourth land. Oh, no. Okay, now he's using green, so maybe he is casting Leovold.
I think we're going to
Danielle has
here,
a blast in his hand. Looks like we might end going to time on this. Oh, no, he's casting Colligan's
Command. I would cast the Command here as well. You want to get a card out of the hand. Your Jace is going to hopefully deal with the... Oh, it was a Strix. It wasn't the Jace.
Blast the Strix, which is sort of what you want, so... That's good for you, and he drew Surgical. Will he think to Surgical Leovold?
Well, no, all he's worried about here is... His Tarmogoyf doesn't die to anything in Diego's deck. Diego won't be playing Abrupt Decay. It's Punishing Fires.
I think he is somewhere.
And there's going to be Diabolic Edicts. So now he's played the Baleful Strix. He doesn't have to worry about...
Danielle holding the Brainstorm.
The Edicts. That's the right way to play it. Don't need it. Doesn't need any cards right now, does he? He's going to win.
He might draw another Tarmogoyf.
He's got another one turn. He's won.
I agree, but this is happening now. And that's unfortunate.
Now the Brainstorm. Well, there's an answer.
True Name Nemesis in your Wasteland basics.
Let's have a talk now about people playing badly and keeping Surgical in their deck when they don't need it.
He kept it in his hand off the Brainstorm as well.
Both of these people have Surgical in their hand at some point, and neither of them use them at all for any reason. It's because I think their opponents are playing Punishing Fires.
Yes.
But Punishing Fire doesn't interact with anything Daniela's doing. Punishing Fire doesn't really interact with anything Diego's doing.
Well, it allows
you
to profitably kill all his Strix and Striges or whatever they're called.
But they don't. It's not profitable, is it? You've drawn a card off your Strix, and he's wasted a card.
Yeah, but there's no other real way of getting rid of them. Whereas you can get your Punishing Fires back. I don't know. I think
I think these Surgicals from both people... I think it's more defensible from Diego because he has Planeswalkers to protect from Punishing Fire.
Okay, that makes sense.
I think it's not very defensible from Daniello to be playing Surgical. Oh, here we are.
And now he's Surgicaling Toxic Deluge, which I'm going to bet is a one-of.
Yeah, I would say so. But it's also the only card that is going to beat you at this point. So definitely the right one to do.
Does he have... Maybe he does have another one. Edict. Thoughtseize. Another Surgical. Oh, no, there is another deluge, I think.
So.
Oh, no. He missed.
That's a Liliana, I think.
What is this deck?
Which one are you talking
which
about?
One? I mean, they're not the same deck. I mean, you could argue that they're the same deck.
It's... Well, Waterfalls has been around for a while. I'm not in this exact variant with True Names and stuff like that. But, you know, the true value, let's see how much we can push Cascade, has been around for a long time. It's just not very good against Wasteland.
No. But it is apparently good if you have Wasteland in your deck.
But Punishing Dak is kind of a... How do I put this? A kind of symptom of the inbred state of Czech Pile and how that got recently. You know, you're going to beat your opponents
by playing
Baleful Strixes
more colors.
By playing more colors because they're not playing Wastelands.
Concedes the True Name.
Well, I would there. I'm on three.
Aston is saying, another feature match with no goblins. When will the hatred stop? Aston, nobody so far this tournament has cast hatred, so I really wouldn't worry about that. I'm actually not sure what you're getting at here.
I think we have two Goblins players in the room. One has never played it before, and one has an all-foil deck. So we'll choose the person who's never played it before to go on stream.
Sound logic there from Tom Kellogg.
It's opposite day.
So is that game two?
I believe so, yeah.
So this is probably a draw.
Yep.
I mean, let's not make any snap predictions, but...
No, he's got Wastelanders. This is.
Oh, he's got here.
Just everything.
Jace, Leovold. He has Planeswalkers as well.
Really? Well, you're playing a blue deck. Why don't you play Jace? Why don't you play a double black him? I mean, Punishing Fire as well. Oh.
Who let Danielle acquire duels? That seems like a dangerous thing. Is that a cutting and Bloodbraid Elf? Sorry.
I don't agree with that. I must say.
That looks like he just cut a Bloodbraid Elf. Goblins are white these days and are called Death and Taxes. Smack talk in the chat from old school Chris C.
Well, I always like people calling goblins little green men because goblins in Wizards lore are green.
Nice. I'm glad that you like that.
But no,
we only something that makes our hearts warmer at night, you know, in the winter nights.
Well, I sit there all alone crying into my pillow.
And then you think, oh, goblins are green. Lovely.
Well, you know, elves versus goblins, I'm sure. This isn't lost on you, Francis. It's just awful.
Sorry?
It's not lost on you that little green men are elves as well. There we go.
Sorry, I'm just having an epiphany. What about merfolk? Where do they fit in?
I've never heard the term merfolk. You've got three more hours of my witticisms.
Danielle's
so
mulliganing.
Save yourself.
3 hours.
I mean, I can't imagine that a deck that plays four colours, Wasteland,
we'll
and
have to
plenty
mulligan.
Of dual two coloured spells is going to have to mulligan. What card do you think we should have up? Let's have Dak Faden up, the namesake of
nice
Diego's
card.
Deck that we've not seen. He probably only plays one or two, maybe even takes them out.
Exactly. I don't know why you take them out here.
But I really like this.
You might want an E in Dak Faden.
There?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
So,
there he is, the greatest thief in the multiverse.
In this match, he may gain control of a Shardless Agent. So Danielle scries and keeps on top. He kept a Brainstorm on top. Interesting decision. Plays a turn one Deathrite
well.
Shaman.
The Strixes, remember, on the opposite side of the deck.
Yes. I remember, Dak Faden and Strix. That does sound a bit better, actually.
Yeah, it's rather good, yeah. You protect... I think this card is best in cube.
Punishing Fire. Not vintage.
No, I think it's actually better in cube.
Wow. You heard it here first.
I mean, everyone plays artifacts, don't they, in cube. Everybody's playing
and
artifacts.
And in vintage, apart from Dredge.
Yeah, well,
but, you know.
Well, there we are, so not everybody.
Is that a magic deck?
I've played Dredge to a reasonably high finish. I think a top four to vintage... UK Vintage Championship with Dredge? All eight people who are playing?
Actually, Dredge does play artifacts.
I'll let
you think about this now. It's a sideboard card.
Grafdigger's Cage?
Dredge would not play Grafdigger's Cage.
No.
Quite bad in Dredge. So, Danielle casts his Brainstorm on turn two. I'm not sure why. I don't think he was missing his land drop, but...
So we've got Patters UK wondering if we're innovative or inbred. I think it's neither, to be honest. I
are these tasting the fact that you good?
I think the fact is you get to play every week, so you can you don't have to be playing something super competitive all the time.
People play. You can be relaxed. Fun things. There was one night a couple of years ago where at least half the field all decided to play tin fins at the same time. These things happen.
I mean, there's if you have, I don't know, a surfeit of Legacy to play, you know, there's Legacy on Tuesday here, Wednesday and Thursday in other parts of London.
You can do what you like, really.
You can do what you like, really, because, yeah. Or, let's pretend that these people are testing seriously for the GP that these decks are going to play.
So the artifact that was played in Dredge is four colorless mana, I believe. Might be five. For a 4/4 that gets cheaper when you discard cards.
Oh, the new version of Dredge. Well, I wasn't playing that one. I wasn't playing Hollow One in my Dredge deck.
Hollow One, that's the card.
Yeah. But I do like that card.
It's a shame. We're just not talking about this game because... Oh, things are happening now. Thoughtseize is being cast. What would you take here?
It depends what's in my hand.
You have a Liliana.
I've got Liliana, so I...
Why are you taking Hollow One? That's odd.
That probably, yes.
That seems fine.
To stop a... let my Jace resolve or something.
Because he has Grove, so there's no point in taking Plunging Fire. Him. It's a very reasonable draw.
I like him to Turok as a card.
Why?
I'm sure it's a card that you don't like. I think it's just the epitome of a good rate on a card.
I think somebody once said, have you ever misdirected an Ancestral? That's rather rude. And if you misdirect a Hymn to Turok, that's justice.
Yeah, I like that.
Seems like these decks fall hard to anyone playing real cards like Blood Moon.
Well, that is big talk there. That is big
okay,
talk.
Okay, Patters. Ah, Cracky found another artifact, Bleeding Dredge, Serum Powder.
Yes.
You must have been playing Serum Powder.
Yes, of course I was playing
Serum Powder. Would you not love to deck fade in your opponent's Serum Powder?
I mean, it gives you mana, right? But I'm not sure I'd ever cast a Serum Powder in... my
are
Dredge
sure?
deck, would I?
There, oh,
there
is, Dredge
there's
deck.
No way I'd be casting that. I have played Serum Powder in a Metalworker deck.
Shops deck, yeah.
Yeah, Shops deck in Legacy that was hoping to, you know, turn on Metalworker people. And I have cast it there and used mana. That was fine.
So
it's not a good deck.
This is not going particularly interesting.
Oh, his own Hymn to Turok.
All right, so they're just hymning each other.
Okay, what art is better? Let's talk about that then. We'll have a discussion of
which Hymn to Turok art is best.
Well, there's five, aren't there? Isn't there?
So I play with the cloak ones whenever I play this card.
Is that one there?
No.
Okay.
It's not that one though.
Should we see what art? Oh, comes
which one
up
comes
from
up? I'm going to bet that it's Eternal Masters.
I bet it is. I bought four of the FTV ones. You have to press this button.
Why on earth did you do that?
Because that was the first printing of four Hymn to Turok, and I played a lot of Pox at the time. I don't like this art.
No, that card is... Mm.
My favourite art on Hymn to Turok... the dog one is one that everyone goes for, I've got to say.
Dog one?
Yeah.
The wolf one?
But, do you know what I mean?
I like the circle one.
Got. And it's a little... The circle one's one
I
use.
I like the one with the cloak.
I have this. I use four of the circle one. But everyone goes for the wolf one. It's a little bit metal
Comics
t-shirt.
Comics 84.
I know that.
I know who that is.
I know who that. Do I know who that is?
Is that Stifle?
Yes, Stifle. Welcome to the stream.
Welcome, Simone. They are not signed. So all different four, all signed. Yeah, that definitely is Simone.
That's definitely the sort of thing
that Simone would do. Doggo Francis. Oh, Cracky Senior is...
getting a little bit little
Max
bit
Dorshan also seemed to Doge is best. Comic says definitely Stifle. So Stifle's
something
apparently...
Something has happened.
We've just stopped talking about this game.
Something has
this
happened.
This is what this means.
Oh, so you cast your Surgical.
Sorry. Bloodbraid into... Childless Agent into Surgical.
And here is where you see...
And now look, that card doesn't do anything. I bet it will. I bet he'll hit now.
Well, this is the important thing to talk about. So when Shardus was a
Hello,
big
Minnie
deck...
Hello, Minnie
Mouse. When Shardus was a big deck in Legacy, when it was, you know, a tier one deck...
Yes.
Some people played Surgical, and other people played four Ley Line of the Void or three Ley Line of the Void in the sideboard, so they could still play their Shardlesses and not have awful cascades like this. Do you think...
I agree.
Yeah.
I think that's a we should be playing Leger principle, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Hello, Aston.
Some other people... I think if I was playing Graveyard Hate, I would be cascading into something I could use when I needed, like a Nihil spell bomb. If that's what something I really...
Players love Surgical because they can bring it in any matchup.
Yeah, I mean, I can fill my deck with cards I never use. I mean, yeah, admittedly, Cracky, the game is a bit of a grind fest here.
The best stream commentary is when they don't talk about the game, seriously.
Ah, that's a fatal push.
Fair enough.
Anyone doesn't know, that's the foil fatal push from FNM. Did you win, Claude?
Well, we'd like to know.
The stream would like
We're
to
holding
know.
The stream up, Claude. Sorry? Claude Schmidt, known Wonder Kid, is not telling us whether he won or not in his first ever match with Els against
smiling,
Callum.
And he didn't move away and like throw my deck around or stomp off like he did.
I bet he beat Callum.
Do you think he beat him? Honestly?
No, but Callum's quite good. But Min, what are you swearing about? I mean, it's rather rude, and this is a family stream.
This is a family stream.
The round is sort of dragging on, rather. There are a few pairs still playing, as well as our match. Snapcaster Mage is in play now, and is being paid for.
I think what's hard...
Brainstorm has been cast, okay.
I think what's hard to commentate on this is that it's really hard to talk about a strategy that either player needs to take to win this game. It purely is, what do I draw off the top, and I'm going to... I'm going to run out
yeah,
my cards.
Yeah, it's not very... There's no line other than... I want to get 2-for-1s.
Yeah, so this, you know, Diego has a him and a fatal push. He's going to fatal push the thing he, you know, one of those cards.
Oh, he's attacking. Well, Snapcaster, so he might
block,
get
right?
to. Yeah, so if they block, he gets to fatal push Bloodbraid Elf.
Yeah.
He could fetch anyway, so yeah. He can do that if he wants. But he might end up doing that anyway. Look, he's going to fetch, push Bloodbraid Elf, and him in. And then Danielle ends up
gonna
with.
Draw a him
Danielle has 2 cards in hand, so that's quite convenient, I believe.
Oh, it's a Deluge.
Oh, Deluge.
We misread that.
Well, I didn't see that.
Maybe it was Deluge and him.
I think he has all of them.
Ah, here we are.
You put a pile mirror on camera instead of Callum's piles. Are there miracles decks? A clip to you saying, hello, Minnie Mouse. Wow. Anteater Tamer. Oh, very nice.
There is a what's the word for...
We didn't get to choose this match being on camera.
Blue control. It's because they were ready in time. Yeah. And
Callum was clearly too slow.
Well, the nice thing about this is I now am sated for waterfalls. I never need to play the deck.
I never need to play this deck. No, this is just... I mean, I didn't even enjoy playing Shardless, so...
Really?
I played Shardless, yeah. And I was just like, this is boring. Oh, look, a 2-2. I drew some cards, but the cards aren't very fun.
Nick had talked to me about how to play Shardless.
Nick Janaeus.
He was very good at that. And his method was to treat it like a control deck. And I feel like Daniele can't play his Cascade deck like a control deck. It's too aggressive. So he can't choose when he needs to shard. He needs to jump into something, when he needs to Cascade into something, which is the point of the Shardless deck, was to, I need to Cascade now into an Abrupt Decay, or something that finds me an Abrupt Decay, so I'll play my Shardless out. I've forced something, I've, you know, killed something else early on. He can't do any of this, because he doesn't have reactive spells. It's play a time and go see what happens.
Yeah. Maybe that's why I don't like it. Snapcastering Surgical Extraction on Brainstorm.
I mean,
you saw it here first, folks.
Because in response, Diego would probably play his Brainstorm.
Yep.
So
and use the shuffle to put the bad cards away.
That'd be, in fact, helping him. But there we are. We see the edict that I mistook for a him.
Ah, it's an edict. I did think it was a him. Min is... Yeah. Anteater Tamer thinks value. I mean, I suppose value?
It's not.
Oh, interesting. Brainstorm into 3 lands.
Essentially, he's thinned the other person's deck, and they now...
I mean, they now might draw more lands than Brainstorms.
Well, there is that chance, isn't there?
Oh, Thoughtseize.
Oh, that's a concession.
They were not updating their life totals.
No, that's a draw.
Oh, they ID'd.
I bet that's a draw.
Were they on turns?
Is that draw? It's 1-1-1.
Anteater saying sarcasm. Is anyone playing lands today?
Is anyone playing lands? I'll go and have a look, and we'll hopefully get them on stream, because that's actually got some lines we can talk about.
Okay, well, that was a lineless match. I'm glad that we've learned that. I know I've just taken us back to the booth, but are we going to...
I think we are going to go to...
Round 2?
Yep, if you want me
to be able to be right back, and we'll find the find who's going to play next.
All right, see you in a bit.
See you soon. I'll cut my check my hair out.
Hello, everybody, and look at our faces again.
Stop leaning so close to the camera.
Yes.
This
round we have Callum Whitefaces Smith from The Source, otherwise also from London, I suppose.
Reddit. The Eternal Weekend
Stream,
top 8
Eternal
once.
Weekend top 8 last year.
Did well with that deck that he mostly tried to build. What was it?
Bant's Deathblade thing.
I had arguments over what name to call it.
That
Darkblade.
Noble Hierarch and Leovold. Yeah, he's pretty good. He's playing
a new guy called Stephen Broadhurst.
I think it's a new player.
And I played him a couple weeks ago. He's a lovely chap, and he's playing Burn,
it's
as
convenient.
Often new players do. And I suppose.
Haha, Minifer.
We should get down to the.
Yes, let's go to the match game table.
Ah, here we are.
All right, and
as we've
the wrong way
with
around.
Some foreshadowing.
It's the wrong way around, I believe.
You can't see.
Yes, right, the wrong way around.
Okay, so.
All right, let's quickly change these.
Okay.
Sorry, Callum. Oh, is there a switcheroo button?
I think, yeah, but you've done it now.
On here. Yeah. Is that going to switch the decks? No.
No, wonderful.
Excellent.
Okay.
All right,
oh,
everybody.
It's animated as well.
Oh, wow,
nice?
Very nice. So Callum is playing a classic Callum line of Island Portent, and he saw a foreshadow, a counterbalance, and a snap custom mage. Not foreshadow. Set Adrift.
Oh, wonderful.
So we have a foreshadow on screen, but let's pull up Set Adrift, because that's another card that we're not really.
Well, that's a card from that recent set that had Naga and
from
Khans. Is it
something
from Khans?
Of Tarkir, either.
Yes,
probably yeah. Khans of Tarkir.
And I think Noah Walker played it in a Grixis Delver list.
Faithless Looting, come on. Give us a moment. Stephen Broadhurst, turn one, Monastery Swift Spear, Mutagenic Growth, his Swift Spear.
Oh, that's a nice play. I like that. I think Callum's
going to
find this
quite
a hard start.
Not going to be very happy with this. Callum is playing exactly zero copies of Swords to Plowshares in his main deck.
Is he really?
Yes.
Is it all unexpectedly
absent? He's playing
absent?
Three unexpectedly absent, a two Set Adrift.
Oh, wonderful.
I meant Callum's deck, not you guys. Okay, Faith of Losing. I'll let you off this time. Thank you, Cracky Senior, on the set naming arc. Tundra Counterbalance.
The Counterbalance is going to do some work here.
Counterbalance is a little brutal. Stephen reading Counterbalance, not where you want to be as a Burn player.
No,
really?
No, but I think perhaps just not caring about it and not being afraid is the way to be here.
Yeah,
you're
going
to have to play into it. There's no top on in the battlefield, you know. So just don't worry. Go.
Stephen cracks his wooded foothills casually.
So, there's a Vexing Devil. We can talk about that. Do you think
we can?
Yes.
It's
one
mana 4/3 that could deal 4 to you.
The problem, though, is if you. Yeah, there are two kind of thoughts when you're building Burn, or two questions you have to answer. Do you want to play Fetchlands to thin your deck?
Play Grim Lavamancer.
Thinning. Or do you play Fetchlands and Grim Lavamancer?
On Syrian Blaze.
Or you don't play Fetchlands. That's the kind of one of the conversations in Burn.
Seems.
Yeah, Syrian Blaze in creature matchups, of course. But that's one of the conversations Burn
Callum
deck builders
explaining
have.
Counterbalance to Stephen here.
And the other, this is much more interesting. So,
all right, sorry.
is should you be playing cards like Vexing Devil, which give your opponent the choice, and the wisdom is that you shouldn't play Burn cards that give your opponent a choice because they'll always choose the one that's best for them. So Vexing Devil, if Callum's got an unexpected absent, doesn't do anything. But if it's going to do 8 damage, then Callum will just take 4. So I don't think he should be playing Vexing Devil in his deck. That's a long way of saying.
It might be a budget choice.
It may well be a budget choice, yeah.
Stephen has 2 Price of Progress in hand. Not particularly good against this deck, I think. But Callum has drawn a Volcanic Island, which he may attempt to brainstorm back at some point. We'll never know. We can't actually see the top of Callum's deck, which is unfortunate in this circumstance.
Okay, I'll shall I go and ask them?
Yes, that's probably
good.
Yeah,
I'll get to move his deck a little bit closer and get his graveyard down. But one sec.
Yes, Min, we've realised this. Comics 84 has played Set Adrift in Blue-Red Delver. Congratulations. Set Adrift apparently sees good vintage play. I've not quite done that before, but... Yes? Right. Callum is moving his deck. Right. They both move their decks. And their playmats. Excellent. That's better. Callum's deck isn't really completely on camera, but I'm sure it'll do okay. Callum chose to draw another set adrift for turn. Oh, he's cast Terminus, so I missed that completely. You weren't here. You missed Terminus.
Well, I wouldn't have missed it if I was here, but you, the Miracles Master.
We need to tell Stephen that Swift Spear goes under the top of the deck, underneath the deck.
We do, yes. Callum should notice that as well.
Callum. Callum, come on. I bet you won't notice. He's not noticed yet.
It's not too problematic, is it?
Let's be Terminus honest. Was blind. Can we find Callum's decklist anywhere? No.
Yes, Set Adrift is Spice. I can confirm that it is Spice. It's been played in one deck in Legacy before. Ever. Grixis Delver. Ah, there's the blind flip.
That was a Plains. That's quite a good draw for Callum, really.
Nice second looking Plains as well.
Callum, loath as he probably is to admit it, likes his nice cards. Not foils, but likes his nice cards. Price of Progress remaining on the stack whilst Callum's having his turn.
Confused by that. But we can give Stephen, you know, a bit of a slack. He's only started playing
there
Legacy.
You go. He's noticed. And he might have noticed that Monstrous Beast shouldn't be in the graveyard at this point.
It's not up to him too much. It's up to both of them. And the much more experienced player should be noticing that.
Callum is not playing Rip. No, he's playing, I believe his win cons are 3 Snapcaster Mages and 2 Jaces. He might have an Entreat in the main. I can't remember. He was considering it in the pub. But he's playing 4 Portent, 3 Unexpectedly Absent, 4 Ponder, 4 Brainstorm, 3 Counterbalance.
And some Foreshadows, which should get those Foreshadows back.
And he's playing 2 Foreshadow, which are not... He's not playing 4 Death Shadow, as you might think by saying Foreshadow. He's actually playing 2 copies of this card, which is like Predict, but you can only target your opponent. And you draw it in your opponent's upkeep.
I wanted to make a joke about foreshadowing and how we had it up on the screen, but unfortunately you started talking before I could...
Sorry, I'll shut up.
No. The moment's passed, but...
Okay, Cracky Senior. I'm not sure who Cracky Senior is, but he is aware that Jay played a Miracles deck with Hedron Alignment.
Well, he obviously follows the Library of Pendrell Vale and looks at the deck lists. Because that was featured deck on my website there.
That might have played Set Adrift as well. I was not aware of this.
Well, I wouldn't say that Jay's Hedron Alignment deck is a tier Legacy deck like Noah Walker's Grixis one on the SCG circuit was. I mean, I'm sure Jay will be upset to hear that.
Jay, if you're listening, Tom Kellick is no longer your friend.
But I think that I think we can
other excellent decks played by Jay. Jay top 8 at London Legacy Monthly.
You're laughing at the same thing as me.
With blue green merfolk, with ancient tomb, and main deck seed time.
Yeah, well, that was in the. Oh, there is foreshadow.
If I say that you are a little Welsh boy, does that give you a clue who I am? Hi, George.
France isn't really that little, though, are you?
No, I'm not that little. Callum's casting Foreshadow and Predict and drawing cards and has a counterbalance in play, and Stephen doesn't appear to be doing very much.
Well, he's only on 4 life, and Callum doesn't have a Force of Will in hand, so something like a Fire Blast will end this game.
Maybe.
Nice and
quick. There might be a Terminus on top. Poor Stephen, he doesn't know any of these cards, not because he's new to Legacy, but because these are completely unplayable. Whoa. He does have Entreat the Angels.
He's gone for
he's
a win condition. Force. Isn't that cheeky?
And he's found Force. Okay. He beat that today and lost. Okay. Well. Snapcaster Mage is the real win condition, I think.
I think so, yeah. He was showing me a deck that was based around Sapphire Medallion.
Yes.
And he had actually conceded to have a win condition of Lightning Bolt in his Sapphire Medallion deck.
He said his win conditions were Lightning Bolt and...
Oh no, there was a thing in the ice.
Thing in the ice. Yeah. I have lost to that deck. Which London Callum is that sometimes plays Ant? I'm not sure Callum play. I don't think Callum's ever played Ant.
No. No, in fact, I think he was... An options tonight were play this awful deck, play...
Miracles.
Play Nykthvit. I was going to bring him some cards for that. Or play Ant, and he said, "I am awful at Ant. I can't play it. I won't."
I think it is one of the few decks that Callum will readily admit that he can't play, or maybe he hasn't played very much.
I can't play Ant either. I tried it once. I went off premature every time.
Right. Well, enough about that.
And if the chat sniggers at that, then
Callum is Force of Willing a Chain Lightning, and there is another Chain Lightning. Callum cracks his fetch line and is hoping to hit blind. If he misses. I'm expecting him to just lose.
That would be quite a nice turn up for the books, wouldn't it?
He's cutting him. Will he cut him to the one? He does. Counterbalance, stellar as always.
The blind flips are the worst flips, aren't they?
They're the best flips.
No, they're the worst for the opponent.
The blind flips are the best flips.
Nick nearly slapped me when I blind flipped a force to his force once. And rugged over. He is very upset.
Counterbalance is lovely. It's really not very fun at all for anyone. And he's remarkably good.
He's found another force as well, but he'll be down to one. So the fetches will be turned off.
Never lucky. Yeah.
He's going to hard cast this one, though, yeah?
Apparently he's going to draw a two.
Do you think he's worried about the...
Who's it two? Yeah, I'd probably
take... keeping you up, Francis? We're keeping you up?
I think I'd take Snapcast damage here. I think he did. Let's see.
Why would you take Snapcast damage?
Because you have a predict in your graveyard, and you've left the 4 second from top, so you can snap predict your other one away.
This is the kind of incisive commentary that we need.
These are cards that I can get behind.
What are the three cards in Stephen's hand? So Stephen has a Lava Spike, a Lightning Bolt, I think another Lava Spike, and if I had to guess, I think that looks like an old Incinerate.
Ah, Snapcaster Mage, targeting Predict. Oh, look.
It's like, well, at least now there are lines for you to talk about rather than complain.
Well, I understand this deck.
Now you have to.
Oh, look, he drew Force and Portent, and now he's going to try and blind. Ooh. Set Adrift doesn't quite cost the same as Lava Spike.
But
famously, one of
him.
Callum's. Well, he's dead. Because Steven has Lightning Bolt.
Bolt him in response! Come on, Steven.
Lightning Bolt.
If I shout too loudly.
So he's casting Lava Spike.
Can I just say that Lava Spike is Callum's least favourite card?
Oh!
No, sorry, Reality Smasher.
Reality
is
Smasher.
Now, but for many years.
It
was his least favourite card.
You think it's. Yes.
And well, so there's some justice in the world where the awful Counterbalance deck loses to the second Lava Spike.
I mean, I would definitely disagree, but I'm also, you know, a little biased.
I would say you were quite biased.
If Callum had a Soothsaying, he could have UA'd it to the top of his deck.
Now, I agree there.
True hates control. Soothsaying, eh?
So what is Steven going to be bringing in the sideboard? I think if he has
needle.
Them, he'll be bringing in the uncountable burn spells with the charge run, what they're called.
Exquisite Firecraft.
Let's bring that one up for people.
He probably also would like to bring in Sulfuric Vortex.
Yes, getting that down is going to end the game nice and quickly.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, you got it right. You spelled it correctly.
I'm impressed as well.
You're impressed by yourself. Well, I do actually quite like the art on that card.
Me too. I like that one.
Might be the only part I do like about it.
Well, no, it's got a good casting cost. Three is a very.
It's got a good name.
Solid cost.
I even don't mind the first part. It's more the second part of that spell.
But you can honestly now. That card, I think, is a well-designed card. It becomes uncountable, but it's 3 mana. That's an expensive card in Legacy terms. And you have to do stuff. You have to spell mastery to get it going. I think you're meant to here to be an unbiased commentator.
Sorry, that's unbiased.
To all
I think this is part of my feeling around game design.
Okay.
And I don't like cards that simply say you can never do something. And you can't counter this is one of the things that I dislike.
Really?
About.
I really like the design space, which admittedly this is in that design space, but the design space of things like Abyssal Persecutor, which break the rules of the game. That's how you design cards. You set up the rules, and then every new magic card is one that changes the rules in some subtle fashion.
But Abyssal Persecutor doesn't prevent anyone from playing the game. It doesn't prevent your opponent from playing the game.
No, I know, but you know it's opposite. Platinum
yes.
Angel does.
Sort of. I suppose that's a far less unpleasant card.
So we're talking about Chalice of the Void here. This is.
Well, why have we got onto this?
We're tiptoeing around.
I actually
Chalice
don't
of the Void.
Mind Chalice
okay.
as much as some other cards.
Right. Okay. So
Sanctum Prelate. I dislike.
I disagree
more.
On that one. Yeah. Sorry. I agree on that one. So the of the uncountable cards we see in Legacy, we'll count Chalice as that one as one of them because it is. Makes things
yeah, but you can counter Chalice.
You can, but you know it stops people playing the game in the same way as Sanctum Prelate.
If your opponent's good, or if you're online.
Okay, that's true.
I have bolted someone for lethal through their chalice before.
Oh, I've won many games through chalice in real
life.
Like
the last 3 points of damage, like, I'll bolt you, look at them, and they go, oh, okay, and they pick up their cards. You're like, oh, there's a chalice avoidant point. Oh, wow, that's unfortunate, isn't it?
Or you can always go with the, you know, play gamble, it gets countered, and then at the end, in their end step, when they're thinking about doing something else.
Crop rotation.
Oh, that resolves. Oh, look, I've won. That's why I think the card's fine, because in real life, you can... The
Sanctum Prelate is you're not allowed to try.
You can't even cast the card.
And I believe there's some reasoning around we tried to fix Chalice of the Void.
This is one of the fixed cards, isn't it?
You made it less fun, significantly less fun, in that you can't play the game if you have those cards.
There we are. That is the card. I mean, it's three mana.
Show and tell.
I think the design space there on the 2/2s, the white 2/2s, is getting crowded as well.
Maybe. I've judged ruled through Chalice at PT's GP. I'm not sure what that means.
No, I don't know.
Oh, what? You call a judge and you say they've missed it, so you kill them?
Well, of course.
Yes, of course. I agree.
My opponents just often miss it and we keep going. And you don't
you just keep playing the game and they look at you a couple of turns later and they're going, why is Deathrite Shaman in play? And you go, this is fun, isn't it?
They often don't forget again after that. It's often Tabernacle triggers are the similar kind of thing. They won't forget the second time.
Well, I don't think you have a chance most of the time.
No.
You don't forget your second Tabernacle trigger because you never have a creature in play again.
Well, in game three, I'm playing Tabernacle now, and they go, I remember this.
Four rituals through a chalice. Okay, that's quite impressive.
Oh, wow. Okay. If you managed to play the first one and then you played the second one and they, you know, were on the stack and you were saying, I've got mana in my, you know, in mana pool, then I...
Maybe they were waiting for you to cast your big one-drop payoff spell. I'll kind of that one.
Oh, that would have been great, though, wouldn't it? I think that might be against the rules, though, to know that your chalice is countering and not
It
and
is.
Not
you're allowed to forget, but you're not allowed to knowingly not do it.
Mm. That's a mistrigger.
Sanctuary Prelate, best card ever made. Yes. I feel like you might be biased... Who won game one?
Oh, sorry. Stephen
Broadhurst won game one. I'm sorry.
With a lava spike. We are awful at this.
We are bad at noting down changes.
We're doing our best, but I don't like. I'm very happy for people to like cards like Sanctum Prelate. Let's bring up.
I think there was an interesting. What is changing Stephen's name?
Oh God, sorry. I was going to change his name to a card.
Are you going to look up what's that 4-mana 2/2? That was discussed on a Star City stream recently. It's a new card in Standard.
Oh, I'm not going to
4-mana 2/2 Necrotol, but it doesn't have First Strike. It doesn't.
The Chupacabra thing. Is that the one?
Ravenous Chupacabra. Yes. We're not going to go on about this, but there is an excellent piece of commentary done by Patrick Sutherland on why that card is terrible game design.
Is it really?
Yes, of course it is.
Why is he not like the design on that card?
So, Standard is a format for... people who want to play Magic.
Yeah.
Magic is interesting when people make risky decisions.
I mean, I don't know how to spell this card, so it's not going to happen.
Okay.
I can spell Ravenous correctly. Chupacabra?
Yeah, like Chupa Chups.
Chupacabra.
So this card prevents people from making risky decisions. You're not going to play your Baneslayer Angel if this exists, number one.
Okay.
Number two, it's... boring. It's not interesting at all. It is the most vanilla thing possible. Necrotol had First Strike.
Why
it's
is
different
the, why
in
is
combat.
The Chupacabra doing this thing? You know,
if Flavor Flay doesn't make sense, why does it not kill non-black creatures?
Yeah. Do you think we should be commentating on the game rather than the current
playing?
Design standard?
Are they playing? Okay, they are playing. They're not just sideboarding. Somebody cast Ponder. Shocking. In Legacy. Callum playing an Arid Mesa. That's... not also that.
Do we think that Steven's brought in some Pyroblasts?
Blessing my
there's the
Vexing
Devil.
As opposed to turn one Monastery Spear.
So I think this card shouldn't be in Steven's deck because Callum said, okay, it resolved.
Maybe he likes it.
No, but he's going to put it on top. He's going to, you know, or he's going to block with a Snapcaster.
Maybe he likes the card. Based on your previous argument, people are allowed to like cards.
That's true. How do I put this? You can like cards, but if you want to win, you should play the best ones.
Anteater thinks Callum has a Terminus. You might well do.
Well, this is the thing. He has an answer. That's why it's on the battlefield. So it's already not going to be useful. Unless Callum's playing badly, then you're one mana. You've wasted one mana in your deck, and you've wasted the point where that could have been a Goblin Guide.
He could have played a turn one Monitor Swiftspear. That was an option available to him.
Yeah.
Callum notably has two Tundras in play.
Ah, so there was a
Did
combo.
Did Stephen side out his prices?
Well, that...
Callum playing his cards correctly and triggering his Terminus.
Callum is missing here a... he's missing a land drop, though, by the look of it.
Yes.
That could be problematic.
JJKBB2005 thinks that Dexing Devil is terrible.
I'd agree. I think that... Is that JJ?
What?
I recognise that name. That Twitch name.
Not sure. Okay, so Stephen is choosing to play one Monitor Swiftspear?
Post-combat. Well, at least he played around the Terminus.
Yeah, so I'm not sure if Stephen's some sort of soul-reading genius, or...
Apparently Callum lost to him last week as well, so...
Really?
Maybe he's got his number. Burn is... Oh, he's not drawn an island.
Vexing Devil was fine, then they printed Monastery Mentor.
Mm.
Those cards don't really overlap.
No, Vexing Devil Terror is not good because it gives your opponent the option. What's the famous card beginning with B in red? Three mana. You can either draw three cards or you do five damage to them. And they're always going to choose the one that's best for them.
Browbeat,
yes. It's in a similar vein as this. There's been lots of talk about, when people come to Magic or Burn, they say, oh, this card's great. Look at the rate on this. Maybe it's a two mana. Oh, three, okay. Look at that. Draw three cards in Burn. God, that's all going to be lightning bolts. Or your opponent might just take five and not care.
Hmm. I only play Sneak and Show.
Well, often I'm playing decks with Caracasin. That's what I'm doing.
Oh. I often lose to Sneak and Show.
Do you? Oh, okay.
It's a pretty bad matchup.
The old
Miracles.
The Seiju lose the game.
The old I cast Sneak Attack and force your Force of Will.
Yeah, yeah. I'm not a big fan of the Sneak and Show deck myself. Neither is Francis, but he's trying to be polite.
I was sort of thinking maybe we should have a difference of opinion on the stream when you got in there first.
Oh, you wanted to yeah. Right, okay. No, I love Sneak and Show. It's my favorite.
I only play decks with Lion's Eye Diamond. That's fine. That card's kind of cool. Then again, I have played Mono White Stacks and Legacy also.
Well, this man is on my wavelength.
Minifer is clapping.
Oh, is this a fiery charm by the look of it?
Don't say that. I'm thinking about building Sneaky Times.
Well, you can play whatever you like.
What is that? Fiery charm?
Fire charm or something? It's a charm, isn't it?
I think it's fiery charm. F-I-E-R-Y.
Let's see if this comes up.
I may be completely wrong.
Oh, no, that's not a real thing.
That's not a real card, I mean, because it would be this. Maybe.
That's exactly how I spelled fiery charm.
No, you did this. We don't actually know what this card's called.
No, it's hard to see, isn't it? But it got countered by the counterbalance, and Steven's getting in. But at least it triggered his Swiftspears.
Someone pressed the Fury Charm.
Fury Charm. Oh, we were
Thank
there.
You very much. That makes more sense. This was in Modern Masters.
Oh, that would have been rather good then. He would have presumably that gives him double strike or plus two, plus
Steven
two.
Has Sulfuric Vortex and double Prize of Progress in hand. He's going to catch out Callum with his post-board fetching Tundra willy-nilly.
Yes. Well, this does look like some Soul Reader. Keeping the prices in when Callum thinks he's taken the prices out.
Not playing Monitor Swiftspear pre-combat.
Oh, you've wasted your Terminus on my awful Vexing Devil. Well, ha ha ha.
And there is Sulfuric Vortex. And Callum
countered.
Has him
Oh, the Soul Read. Oh, and he's moved it into the screen as well. The Soul Read is there.
That makes me feel warm inside.
But he's still getting there with the Swiftspears. They're now, it's for a turn.
Callum might have sideboarded in his Source Supply shares.
I would have done that myself.
Yes. Stephen has Tormod's Crypt in play.
Well, that's perfectly fine. If you've got cards that, say, maybe...
Callum's shuffling away his entreat. Oh, no, he's cracking in response to it. Sorry, I didn't see it on the stack.
What's the Syrian Blaze? If he's got things like Syrian Blaze in his main deck, he might want to take those out, because they're not doing anything here.
Well, you could target an Angel.
Well, yeah. Ooh, yeah. I mean, I think the Crypt is probably a little bit better if you want to stop the...
Does he give himself prowess triggers, or know how prowess works, or know this is Magic and not Yu-Gi-Oh?
I think he does, yes.
We can interview Stephen after the match and ask him all those questions, but it's unlikely.
Probably rather not. They're quite offensive.
Anzi. Anurag is asking us about angels. Okay.
He's only got a force though back up now, but the predict there is going to keep him going.
He has blind
counterbalance,
which is the tastiest thing ever.
And there's I think he's got a Flusterstorm as well.
Has he got mana? I don't know if he's got mana.
He's got no mana. No. But I'm just saying for the next turn because he's going to block here.
Probably.
Going to probably take four.
I guess so.
Steven's drawing a lot of lands, which is quite unlucky.
That's what happens when you don't play Foreshadow.
He's got three turns of this, though.
Important.
He's got three turns before he's dead.
This is only game two, though. Those two have decided to be played.
That's true. There's some foreshadowing going on there.
I mean, I feel like Callum is definitely in the driving seat
at
this position. He has two Angels in play, a Counterbalance, a Force, a Flusterstorm. I think that's quite good. So Callum's going to flip with Force of Will. So Callum probably won't force this, I don't know.
No, well he can... He's so not going to die to this, is he? He's going to take four.
But there's definitely... So he wants to not die to Exquisite Firecraft. So he's going to keep himself above dying to that because he can't counter that one.
Okay.
And he's fine. He has to take four. So Callum can indeed still profitably block.
Problem is, these cards, these prices are instants. Would it be better to be...
Waiting
and using them?
I mean, Callum doesn't have Flusterstorm available.
No.
And he predicts, draws another Counterbalance, and a Portent, draws for turn. Finds a Jace. Okay, casts Portent.
We might be closing this one out. Cantrip. Would you attack for four here or eight? Or none? And why?
Attack for four.
Yeah. Keep safe.
You need to pressure Steven. If he draws Lightning Bolt and you can't counter it, then... Oh, he's Portent. Of course Callum is Portenting Steven.
That is the sensible... And those two Fire Blasts are going to close this out.
They're underneath a fetch land currently.
Well, they'll stay underneath a fetch land.
Well, it may be that Steven is given a fetch land and decides to fetch away those cards.
Yes. Yeah, that's true.
And it may be that Callum...
Why is he shuffling?
Well...
Oh, he chose to shuffle.
Yeah, so that is the other option here.
I think I'd like to prefer to leave the fetch there.
Yes, I think I would have as well, but I'm not, you know, the foreshadowing master.
Do you, if you were playing in Steven's seat, would you be looking to just get to three or four cards in hand and then try and burn them out in one go? Or are you going to play every card?
If you draw three cards, I think you die.
Well, no, he's only taking four here. Because you want to overload the counterbalance and the force and stuff, don't you?
Yeah.
I don't think you should be playing these one by
What's
one.
What's this? Monstrous Spears. That's much better for Callum.
Yes, it's really good, yeah.
And I'm not sure... Well, Callum doesn't know his top card, does he? So he's probably looking to predict in his upkeep.
I honestly feel like the burn player would have fetched, though.
Steven's made some rather unorthodox plays here. Would you be able to count on that?
No, but I think a good player and a bad player would fetch there. Because you're thinning your deck, in theory.
Slightly less fast cantrip. Thank you, Andy, on your... cantrip speedometer rating. Monastery Swift Spear. Trigger countered.
Oh, that was blind, wasn't it?
Yes. It's almost like the deck's supposed to do this sort of thing.
It's funny how the world's moved back to the counterbalance decks. You know, the current Miracles deck is almost exactly the same.
I think it's delicious. And I would play it. I do play it a lot.
but don't you think it's quite funny that the core that they thought would, you know, we're back to the same place? Are we going to be now, you know, 8 months down the line and they have to ban another part of it? Maybe a year and a half, 2 years?
3 years.
You think 3 years down the line?
They banned top after 3 years.
Yeah.
And top is really, really good.
Maybe you ban something and unban top in some years' time?
No.
I mean, this is not as powerful as the top version. The lockout is not as complete.
It's so less consistent.
Yeah. But you do find your lands as well.
Callum is again attacking with one angel. So, Steven goes down to 10. Sudden Shock.
This is a great card here.
That's probably a bit loud. They might have heard that. Deathrite Shaman will see a ban. Wow. Teroi 2 is...
He's got some strong opinions.
Maybe he's the foreshadowing player here.
That's true.
I don't think this iteration of Miracles is as powerful.
No, I don't think we do.
I agree.
But I think
not the Foreshadow version.
No, but I think the last iteration of Miracles was not as powerful as everyone assumed. But I think,
it
wasn't. I was looking back at a conversation I had with Anders.
Yes.
Recently, he wrote an article about what to ban around that time. And he wanted to ban Deathrite Shaman, and he's totally in love with the Miracles deck, and you know there was
Why
nothing
is
wrong with
sudden
it.
Shocking, though? Sorry.
It's all right. And my argument at that point was I don't think the deck is overpowered. I think that people have just kind of
lethal
let it happen. If you know what I mean, they've given up on trying to beat it, because you can beat the old Miracles deck and you can beat the new one, but it's often easier just to play the best deck, isn't it?
Sort of. I personally think that pre-ban Miracles was something like 10-15% better than the next deck. But
what about the next deck that wanted to beat Miracles?
What deck beat Miracles?
Sylvan Plug was pretty good.
And what other decks did that beat?
Blue decks, mostly, which is, 60% of the format?
I think I'd much rather play Daze than Choke.
No, I just feel like a lot of people...
That card. I like that card.
I thought I'd bring that up. This is the way that Callum hopes to win.
That card's great.
It's great art on Jason the Mind Sculptor.
If Deathrite Shaman sees the manager... representation, I don't think it needs to be banned.
Shall we engage in the Deathrite Shaman ban conversation, or...?
We can have a comment before the next game starts.
Okay.
My personal opinion is that card does not need to be banned.
Shall I play Devil's Advocate, then?
You can.
Deathrite Shaman needs to be banned because it makes the format too homogenous. It homogenizes all of the format. And Legacy's great strength is that it needs to be... you can play almost anything.
How does Deathrite Shaman homogenize the format?
Well, it's black and green.
Yes.
And it fixes mana.
Yes.
So it pushes people into splashing colors, but without the downside of
right.
dual lands.
So that's very true.
And so Wasteland isn't the strongest.
There's no real incentive to play something like Bant without black in it.
What do you mean?
Why would you play a Bant deck without Deathrite Shaman and Leovold?
Exactly. So you're agreeing. You're agreeing with me.
That statement is correct.
Yeah.
I think there are lots of ways of beating Deathrite Shaman.
Okay.
I think that compared to the other cards that have been recently banned in Legacy, it is nowhere close to as powerful as those cards.
Okay, but could you conceive of a ban for the health of the format, for the reason that, you know, it becomes a three deck or a four deck format, or, you know,
what?
You've got the green decks that run Deathrite, you've got the decks that don't run Deathrite, and then you've got all the tier three decks other than lands.
Not sure that's true.
Okay.
So you have Deathrite Shaman decks. Fine. So you have Pyle and Delver.
I suppose I'm just...
And you have some Blade decks. And that's it, really. You have Elves, but that's not a Deathrite Shaman deck. That's a combo deck that has Elves in it. Then you have Sneak and Show and Storm and Miracles and non-Shaman Blade decks and a whole other... I think that's... Death and Taxes. I think there are plenty of cards that beat Deathrite Shaman.
Now, see here, I'm going to disagree with what Archon Blood is saying there, that it shuts down those strategies. I think those reanimated strategies evidently are still as good. The, you know, Black Red Reanimator won a GP. You know, that deck, that still works.
When was the last time Dredge won an event?
I mean, Dredge has never won an event.
Did quite a lot in 2010. Turn 1 Vexing Devil, okay.
8 years ago. It's a reader. Callum's got a reader.
Yeah. So imagine playing Dredge.
Oh, and he's taken 4 because he hasn't got an answer for it. This is where the card is bad. This is why the card is bad.
So it's never the version you want.
But I think I like what Anteater Tame is saying there. Ban Deathrite and reprint it with a mana cost that isn't broken.
That's not something that happens in Magic.
No, it isn't. Because so they should basically do the same
that's
with
like
Trina Nemesis. They should make Deathrite Shaman a 1-1 or a 0-1. You know, it's
a lot of the time I find ban list discussion to be rather irrelevant. Because
yes,
we have no real control over it, and we live in the world we live in where Deathrite Shaman is legal. So you should try and beat it,
but
and not talk about it getting banned.
Well, that's a way of shutting that down, isn't it?
Well, there's a game going on here.
But this is my argument for Miracles as well. when they were banning
it? I don't think they should have banned top, but I think the deck was, because I don't like banning cards.
Okay.
But I can see the reason for that a lot more than Shaman.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah, no, I agree with you there. That's, I think we're in the same boat.
Turn one, Portent.
So this is where Stephen really needs to put on a lot of pressure, get a creature, get 4 or 5 damage in.
Hi, Tom Cutton. But yes.
He's not done anything. He's passed the turn. This is worrisome.
His hand is double Fire Blast, double...
With this on the stack.
Double Fire Blast. I think he should Pyro Blast
Stephen
that.
Stephen needs to do some stuff.
That's quite a good thing to do.
No, but, you know, let's... Is
oh,
he going to force?
Oh, Callum might force back.
Ooh. Second Pyro Blast? That would be quite
no,
good.
No, he has a Lightning Bolt, I think. Maybe he has a Red Blast. I'm not sure. I think he has two Fire Blasts, a Bolt, and a Sulfuric Vortex.
Ah, okay. The Vortex is good then. So don't let it resolve,
he should
Stephen.
Bolt now.
You should Bolt there.
Bolt now.
Please
Bolt. Please Bolt. Please.
I kind
of
feel bad
bolt,
that we
bolt.
Want this front man to beat our friend.
Everyone loves watching Callum lose. Oh, no.
Is Callum going to let him have it? He's going to let him have it.
Yeah.
Oh, no. He's no. Okay. What?
Callum let him have it.
Poking?
I think. He's just... Yeah, Callum let him have it.
I think time considerations for bannings are...
Irrelevant to the game. Yep. Sulfuric Vortex.
I think the problem with people.
So Callum doesn't have force
here
of
we
war.
Are. Oh, close
Callum's
enough.
Probably dead.
I'd say so. Yeah, he's on 11.
Yeah.
I would say that thinking about how to run a GP when there is only like 2 GPs, 3 GPs in the world is an absurd idea.
I don't think the rounds go to time.
Because of miracles?
Any more or any less than they did used to.
They go to time because of slow players, and that's the judging problem.
And lands players, to be honest.
Slow players. Ah, I'm not going to disagree. Although lands wins on surprisingly number early turns as well.
You know I'm being silly.
I know.
Right. So I think that Steven's going to win this game. Callum might prove me wrong.
No, Anti-Tame's got another point. He's got Unexpectedly Absent and Set Adrift, which deal with permanents. So he has a way out of this.
Yeah, but Steven has double Fire Blast in hand.
Yes.
And Sulfuric Vortex is still in play.
Well, Fire Blast is a 6-mana spell, isn't it? So there's nothing in Callum's deck that... Oh, is Terminus 6-mana?
Yes.
Okay, so he has got...
So he can
options.
Counterbalance it.
Ooh, Ash Zealot. Let's get this
what
one up.
What is going on? Ash Zealot?
Yeah.
Oh.
This was printed
nice.
As a direct
answer to Snapcaster.
Answer to Snapcaster, yeah.
Yeah. I remember this. There we go. Snapcaster Mage, way too good. Ash Zealot coming in. And Callum playing Snapcaster Mage.
Yeah. The stars are aligned, I think. I think he knows something we don't know, Stephen.
There he is!
Oh! But the Snapcaster has countered it. That's some bad luck.
That was too perfect, I think.
Do you just Power Blast him here, and you know what's on top, and you win the game?
Does he have Blast in hand? I don't think he does.
No, you've got, Fire Blast.
Oh, Fire Blast him. You could Fire Blast him here.
And really locking
this is
down.
The worst burn list possible. I'm not sure that's true, official JDK. It might be worse than this, you know, tuned machines of current Legacy. But let's play some cards.
He's got a clock.
This
now.
Card does kill the opponent.
Yep, Romario, good to see you here. And yeah, quite a lot of irony there.
So what's going on here? He drew a Barbarian Ring.
Ah, now this is the reason why he's playing fetches. I remember talking to him about this a couple of weeks ago. He's using Barbarian Ring as an uncountable couple of mana.
Have you played Pauper, which will be getting a GP?
Which is great.
Ooh,
well,
that.
It's people are hoping because there was a 300-person event at the GP.
I was there. I saw that. Yeah.
Yeah. And so if there was a 300-person, 3-round event, that means a GP's on the horizon. Because Pauper's great, apparently. I haven't played Pauper.
Really not. No? It is quite fun. It is absurdly broken.
Okay,
that's
so
what
it's probably not a good GP format then.
Well, I don't know if it's absurdly broken. There are lots of really broken cantrips and draw spells, and there are no real ways to kill your opponent.
Okay, that seems...
Apart from Kiln Fiend.
Unfun, to be honest. Yeah, I actually have played Pauper. I played a Kiln Fiend
deck.
Yeah,
I've also played a Kiln Fiend deck in Pauper.
What's the Ravnica card? The 3-mana dwarf? Fair and Alt or something?
Portent your opponent.
This is the time to Fire Blast.
Yeah. Well, no, he's portenting his opponent, doesn't matter. Pauper is fun. Yeah, I think Pauper is fun.
Wee Fairy Aeronauts or something? This is where you see Fury Charm is not a good card. for this. It doesn't do damage without a creature.
Yes.
Or maybe it does. Maybe it does one or two.
I'm not sure. Callum playing Counterbalance to get a monk. Killing people with Dinrova Hollow and Moldrifter is great. Yeah, sure. Thank you, Tara, for notifying us that Mentor beats Vortex.
Is there a discussion on life totals?
What's going on here? Callum is talking.
Actually, Callum, if Stephen realizes that he can, Callum can plow his own guy and get a lot of life back, he should really be doing stuff while Callum doesn't have any white mana on the field.
How much mana does Callum actually have?
Three.
So Callum drew a Polluted Delta.
Mm.
If Callum cracks his he didn't play it, so.
No.
It was an upkeep draw from Porter.
Let's. Just hard cast it.
Fire blast you. Sacrifice these, makes you red. Force of War does not counter that. And yep.
There we go. Have another one. And that's the game.
Callum loses to Burn. That's all. We all love watching Callum lose. Sorry, Callum. We love you really.
But I think it's a good matchup for Burn. That's one of the reasons to play it if people are playing slow decks like this. That
yes, I agree.
That find it hard to deal with.
Burn is unpleasant to play against. It should lose to all the Sneaking Show.
Yeah, and you know, all the combo decks and things like that. But he's got Staring Bridge in his sideboard. He's got answers to it.
Mentor, didn't beat Vortex there.
Mm, that's true. Well, Mentor didn't beat Fire Blast either.
Min is making a good comment that Callum couldn't have gained life when he saw Splashes. Because there was a Silver Vortex in play.
Well, maybe he should be commentating.
Yeah, Minnie Mouse commentating from the back seat.
Backseat drivers, eh? There's nothing wrong with needing Dredge to explain to you. It's
Dredge is complicated. If someone in the chat could tell me how Dredge and Sylvan Library work, that'd be great. So I still don't know.
I mean, I can't, and I've used those cards.
My solution to that is I never play those cards in the same deck. And always call a judge whenever my opponent tries to do something with them.
Yeah, let's go back to the booth. And you can see all the lovely products behind us.
Oh, yes. What have we got? Oh, yes. This evening we have boxes for stuff. Tom Keller.
Come and buy some things.
And magic cards. Armand Kett.
I mean, I don't know. Standard.
Yeah. Hates control. Can hate more than one genre of deck.
Good for him. He's got a lot of hate to give.
That's a mastery of hatred.
So I'm going to
find out a lot today.
If we're having another match.
I would guess not. The round doesn't look like it's ending.
Okay, shall we... So what are we hoping to see in the chat next? What deck we want to see next? I'd quite like to see lands, but no one's playing that tonight.
Hex Depths?
Goblins.
Goblins.
I think we need some goblins in stream. London is known for its...
Neither of us know how to play goblins.
No, I've played goblins at a GP. How very dare you?
So neither of us know how to play goblins.
I own goblins. I've got the goblins deck.
You own lots of decks, Kat.
I do, but it doesn't mean I can play any of them. But yes, yeah. No, I know how the goblins... I can know the cards.
JJKBB is making more comments about us being pasties. I'm not sure.
Pasty, I think he means there.
Really?
I think
I'm just feeling a bit hungry. I'm not sure, but...
Mm. I could do the pasty. I like a pasty.
Yeah.
I've got a Chinese to eat. It's gone very cold. It's on some floor.
Thank you.
You just get to dredge a lot.
Thank
Sultan
you, Cracky.
Library wants you to return cards that
Library.
You drew this turn on top of your library. Sultan you haven't
Library.
Drawn any cards. You dredge them. Silver Library dredging equals gas. Yeah, so what happens is you dredge the first one, which is your draw step. Then you get to draw two more. You can dredge that one and you can dredge that one.
Still don't really get this, but okay.
It says draw a card.
Min is hungry. He wants some pasties. Do mice eat pasties? I suppose they do. If you leave a pasty out in your room, you might get mice.
Do they have Cornish pasties in America? Obviously, they're not called Cornish pasties because they have to be.
No, they're probably a lot bigger.
You get quite a big Cornish pasty, that kind of size.
Well.
So what other decks? I think we'll try and get Goblins on stream next. If anyone has any awful, awful feelings on that, or strong feelings either way. I know someone's playing some Reanimator. That could be...
Someone's playing Food Chain. Someone's playing Hexter.
Food Chain's a good deck to watch.
Could watch that.
What are you playing, Miko? What deck are you playing? Oh, boring.
Someone's playing Grixis Delver.
Yeah, we don't want that.
Honda Civic.
Sorry? It's foil, though, so, you know.
Mika does have an excellent magic collection.
And it's foil and black. It's all black and foil. It's a beautiful deck.
A large pasty is called a hoggy. Thank you, Tom.
But Scots don't make pasties.
America doesn't really have British food. What are you talking about? America doesn't have British food.
I don't know how they live. They don't have kettles.
How do they boil water?
They use a pan, so they can't have proper cups of tea.
Use a pan?
They use a pan. I've seen people on...
How do they make coffee?
Coffee machines. Such a waste, isn't it?
Grim.
It does sound grim.
Sneak and Show, please. I don't know if anyone's playing Sneak and Show.
No, I don't think... Our one Sneak and Show player was playing that awful Dak Faden deck.
Yeah. We use pots, not pans.
Grixis Delver.
A pot is made of clay. A pan is made of metal. If you use pots to boil water, where do you live? Ancient Egypt?
He makes a very good point.
We need full English breakfast. Yes, you do. FedEx.
look at that. Although he's all closed off all his body language.
Yeah, I feel uncomfortable now. I don't like being flirted with. Actually true, I don't like being flirted with. Let me out. You want to see High Tide? I would love to see High Tide. But I saw someone unsleeving High Tide today as I was lending them Miracles. So
Alex often has a good, interesting deck to play.
Alex is playing 4-color Super Greedy Delver.
Oh, that's a shame.
Yeah.
And we might have to be Delver.
I don't mind commentating Delver.
Tommaso often plays a very fun deck as well.
Tommaso often plays,
Smallpox or...
Blood Moon.
Oh, well, yeah, I know. I'm trying to pretend he never plays Blood Moon because it's always Blood Moon these days. But hopefully...
Exquisite Firecrest. Baird, you just missed Burn on Camera.
Hopefully he'll be playing a Smallpox deck. I think we should... We should go and find out what decks are playing.
We'll go to the Be Right Back screen and we'll go and hunt down some decks.
Give us some things in the chat.
Yeah. Back in the booth we are. So, are you excited for this round, Tom?
I am. They asked for it. We provided.
So we've managed to not rig the pairings, but we've been given the matchup you requested.
We have High Tide versus Grixis Delva, which is what two of you asked for, the Grixis Delva versus combo and High Tide on stream. So perfect.
Yeah, I hope you're all very happy about that.
I think someone is. That's all caps High Tide.
Leet Washer. Hmm.
I'm just happy to see Miko's shiny AF Grixis Delva deck. Yep. I don't think Miko's playing as Foretold in his Delva deck. But
no. You know. I don't think so. And Finland, so something. I'm not
also Finland, so Torilla Tabaton. I can't speak Finnish, but that's the noise the letters make to me.
It's similar to Hungarian.
Oh, I speak that, so that's fine.
They're very similar.
Good.
All right, whatever that means. Probably some cool youth talk that we don't
traps.
Understand.
Like Mindbreak Trap?
Right, let's started. Let's see if we
let's go down to the feature. Oh wow, perfect timing, Thomas.
God, it's like I've done this before twice.
Maxwell's laid out his hand. I'm not sure who's on the play.
Let's grab out the what should we have? High Tide to start with, the namesake card.
Sure. I mean, people might know what that does. We'll get into the more obscure cards towards the end, I suppose.
I think Maxwell is playing the is High Tide one word? Oh, come on. No,
High Tide is not one word.
Not the great art either. This.
Whoa, well, it's the Pirates of the Caribbean version.
I suppose so. It's the book promo.
Vintage Masters.
No, it also came with a... you got that one by buying...
Oh, is that Dak Faden?
A magazine, yeah. It's a comic one.
It is a comical one.
Yes, so this is the question. He's playing...
Go ahead. Yeah.
He's playing Time Spiral High Tide, I think.
Yes, he's playing Spring Tide or Spiral Tide or whatever you want to call it. The one with Time Spiral, not Solidarity.
It's the one with candelabras, and there they are. You can see one in his hand.
Candelabra of Tornos. So this person apparently hasn't played a Legacy tournament before, but has access to candelabras, which I find remarkable.
Do you think he's a trader?
I don't know. That's a good solution to that problem.
Oh, and a really ugly Force of Will, I imagine.
Miko leads on Underground Sea Beta, I believe that is.
It could be Alpha.
Be Alpha, and then foil Japanese Delva of Secrets,
yes.
Followed by foil. Scalding Tom.
We should make it well known that Miko is not famous rally driver Miko Hirvonen. He is a different Miko Hirvonen.
Miko is man who has mortgaged his house to buy Magic cards.
I don't think he needed to
no,
do it.
I don't think I don't think he's done that at all. But you know, some people may be forgiven for thinking that.
A friend of mine actually did sell their second set of power to get the mortgage get the deposit nice. For the house.
Maxwell has brainstormed after Gitaxian probing. What do you think of that play?
I'm so confused as to
speechless
what's going on.
So is Tom Kellogg.
So the probe has come in.
Miko probed Maxwell. Maxwell cast Brainstorm.
So what's he hidden? Has he hidden something important like a High Tide?
I don't know. Pat is, yes, you're correct. High Tide is, well, High Tide is generally used for all of the decks that have High Tide in them, I suspect. And Spiral or Solid Spring Tide is Time Spiral and Solidarity is the... reset deck. Why are those forces so bright? I'm not sure.
So, he hit the Candelabra. That is the card that he needs to go off. So,
but he's if he casts it now, he'll be casting it into Daze, which, you know, is he going to play? Is he going to play? He's casting Preordain. Okay, that's fine.
What's the awful foil
Invocation. And he's put it on top. Maybe it's a Daze?
Second down. Could be a Daze.
He can't play any more lands this turn, so.
I feel like protecting things with the Brainstorm and then doing that is not the way I would have played
that's
it.
That's a bit of a waste of a Brainstorm.
I don't know how to play this deck at all.
I think you may still want to follow some of the general rules of playing Brainstorm.
Tom Cadden, Standstill is playable in Legacy. You can PM me or Facebook message me, and I will talk to you for many hours, days even, about how much Standstill is great. Although, LOL, is that toxicity or something? I can't remember.
LOLtrocity.
LOL, wow.
Obviously.
It just slips off the tongue.
I think it was a LOLtrocity.
They are somewhat correct in saying that Wasteland does spoil the deck slightly.
Deathrite Shaman's quite good as well.
Against Standstill
against
decks?
Standstill, yeah.
Well, it depends if there's anything in the graveyard. If it's an empty graveyard, you're
It's a one-mana threat.
I know, and it attacks for one, and your Mistress Factory attack for two. It's
that's true.
It doesn't do anything, you know, until
attack for three. This card might do something.
I think the Delve's going to get him.
It's going to get Maxwell.
Right. Well, Maxwell's what we're on turn.
Got five a turn.
Two
he
here.
Hasn't countered either of the threats, which is interesting. Saving them to bring
he
it back.
He's
going to
go off. That's the plan, though, right?
But he has two lands, a Preordain, a Merchant Scroll, a Candelabra of Tornos, and double Force of Will.
Whose deck's more beautiful?
Miko's.
Yes.
Okay. I'm not a fan of foils, but I like those black border duels. But I don't like these new islands.
I thought, no, me neither. It looks, they're slightly
alien.
Yeah, I think I just haven't really seen them. Maybe I'll get used to them, but they're not.
Merchant Scroll for High Tide.
Now, that is a good art of High Tide. One of the five arts. They have four separate arts in that set.
Really?
Yeah.
I was
a bit like Hint of Turok. It's a Fallen Empires card, isn't it?
Is there a Doggo one?
I don't. Well, you don't really get many sea dogs, so.
Well.
Or salty sea dogs, I suppose.
Exactly.
But no. God, that's the fourth. Is that the fourth Preordain we've seen there?
Definitely the third.
Three arts for High Tide, I'm being told. Well, I'll take it all back.
Thank you, Lead Washer, for correcting our commentary here. And the promo.
So, four arts was correct.
3+1 might be four. Miko is deciding to bolt and drain. So now, if he flips his double secret at 6, 7, 8. So that's one turn clock if he has a lightning bolt.
He does. He's got two bolts. He's got one in hand.
So if Delver flips, I believe Maxwell is dead.
6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Yeah. Okay. This is the problem with High Tide. It goes off on turn four.
Or turn five. Or
I mean, the earliest it can win is turn four often. That's the kind of the critical turn for if you're playing against it, if you're thinking.
Is Lightning Bolt resolved? I'm not sure what's going on.
Lightning Bolt has resolved and the Death Fright has exiled something.
Right,
to do
so does Delver Secrets flip?
It flips to another bolt.
Yeah, that's interesting.
The
so
GGs.
Oh. No, Maxwell has Force of Will.
He's got two forces.
Yeah, but.
I hope Miko sequences this correctly by bolting first.
Tom Cadden, a fan of Miko's deck.
Miko's deck is beautiful.
Miko's deck is very, very nice.
If I could play a, if I could build a deck in a similar vein, I would build it in the way that Miko's doing it. I like the foil Lightning Bolt promos there with the correct Christopher Rush art. I like the foil Delvers. I like foil cards, but I think the Black Border lands are lovely as well. It's similar vein to how I've done my lands deck.
You do have a very nice lands deck. Okay. Brainstorm. Well, if anything's going to get him out of it, that card might, but...
I think I would have done this while he was tapped out, personally.
He's at five, so he's
maybe
basically dead. High Tide. Ooh. High Tide on the stack.
Well, this makes Miko's lands give him more mana as well.
Yes. So he can cast both the Lightning Bolts.
Does it give him two red? It doesn't. It gives him... It taps a rope.
No, he can't, so... Yeah. He can still cast both Lightning Bolts if he wants to. And he probably should, actually, because he'll have to force. And he's correct to fetch, so...
Well, if Miko gets to untap, essentially he's going to win the game. But
I think he's won anyway.
Really? There's two forces in hand. Mm-hmm. This puts Maxwell on one, essentially.
On five.
Well, so there's a force and there's a Lightning Bolt. Force a Lightning Bolt. Can't cast a second Lightning Bolt.
No, he's on four, sorry.
Yeah. Oh, right, so he's gone to... Oh, he used to fetch there, didn't he?
I thought he was dead, yeah.
Yeah, so he is dead now, yeah. Because you Lightning Bolt, he forces, then you use the...
He's just letting him have fun, though. Candelabra has been used. This is a bit risky, I really think.
He's not counting his mana, which would be helpful for us.
Brainstorm.
I did ask them to...
Why is Miko not doing anything? He's just letting Maxwell find things.
Maybe he wants to see what's going on.
What does he think is going to happen?
Our Time Spiral, let's bring that card up. That seems to be important at this point. Well, maybe he doesn't know the deck, you know.
This is
That is an option.
I have no idea what that card is. Capsize?
That's hard to see, isn't it?
If you type in Time Spiral's two words. If you type in Capsize, it'll bring up the latest version.
Okay. Now you've bucketed it.
Ooh, that's not a word. I think that might be Capsize.
Yeah, I agree with you, Tom. I'm not a fan of the unstable lands either.
Come on.
You have to press this button here. It doesn't work with Enter.
Neither of us are very good at using this system, apparently.
It's new to us.
It is. It's Capsize.
God, you're bloody good at this, aren't you? There's the reason why you're in the commentary booth.
And Miko kills him.
Yeah, well, that was going to happen, wasn't it? Do we need him to have his mana on screen? I don't think we do. He gets lots. That's what happens.
I think we're okay.
So what's Miho going to bring in here? You are, or you used to be, a very, very good Grixis Delver player. And I'll pretend like I know what's going on.
Miho wants to bring in Blasts and Fluster Storms.
Okay.
And
what will he cut?
He will probably cut any removal that doesn't go to the face.
Will he have some in there?
He might have a Dismember or a Fatal Push or probably a Forked Bolt after that comes out.
No, don't put the Surgicals in, Miho. Oh, no.
Surgical doesn't really do anything, does it?
No, he didn't. He didn't know. He keep going back.
You might catch their Cunning Wishes.
That's a good point.
But I don't think that's going to work. I can't see anything else I'd actually want apart from the Blast. Has he got any Blasts? Yeah. You could bring in your Abrade, try and get a Candelabra, but normally when they've cast that, you're dead anyway. If he has the Cabal Therapies in the sideboard, you want all of those.
That looked like Young Pyromancers.
In the sideboard?
Possibly. Or something very foil and shiny that I've never seen before. So what's that there?
Is
that
I don't know. Is it the Red X spell that kills artifacts? I would cut Gurmag Anglers and True Names.
Are they too slow here, yeah?
Yes. And Fort Bolt. Yeah, Fort Bolt. Fine. And Wasteland's pretty bad as well. Yeah, so you can cut Wastelands.
Okay. And you want to presumably be spell piercing stuff early. You want to be using that up before High Tide gets you lots
spell
of mana.
Pierce is good. Oh, Miho is having a walk. I'm not sure what he's doing. Miho has left the
booth.
The booth for the feature match and is talking to
the traders. Maybe he's missing a card or something.
I don't know.
Good shot of his head there. Or maybe he's asking them to be quiet so he can concentrate.
Maybe.
It's hard to see. That's an Abrade, isn't it?
Polite young man. So. There is an Abrade in the sideboard. I'm not sure. I think I probably would bring it in. I think you'll have enough to cut that you might even want Surgicals and Abrades. If you're cutting your Wastelands and your Anglers and your True Name.
Would you cut all four Wastelands? Are you down to like 17 lands then? Or just to make some
mana? They don't cast anything.
Okay, fair enough. But I honestly don't know. Yeah, this is what I'm asking.
Wasteland is zero mana kill
something. Stop assuming I know what you know, Francis.
So Wasteland casts Young Pyromancer.
Yep.
That's and Force of Will. And Gurmag Angler, which you're cutting anyway.
Okay, okay.
So you don't want it, really.
And it doesn't cast your Abrade, really.
You might have some fun times targeting their fetch lands and using your Dazers. But you don't want to be doing that, and that's quite niche. So I would cut the Wastelands.
So all four go out, yeah.
Probably.
We're losing the Fort Bolt as well. Probably the two Gurmags.
So you've probably got about eight slots, really. And you're keeping in Lightning Bolt still.
Yeah, it must be, yeah.
So
Surgicals probably do come in. What about that Winter Orb?
That definitely slows them down a lot. If they need four lands untapped to go off...
They do.
You could make an argument for Winter Orb. He can waste his own land to make a mana with Deathrot Shaman, correct? He can waste the Wasteland that he's using.
Yes, you can target itself, yeah. And he's bringing them out, which is good. Maybe he's overheard us. Don't take out the Lightning Bolt, Miho.
Well, he might be able to. I don't actually know exactly what his sideboard map is for High Tide. I'm sure he's got it all planned out.
And what about the High Tide player?
He might keep in his threats over his Lightning Bolts, but...
What will the High Tide player bring in? Is there nothing they can do to speed up?
I have
no idea. No, but that's spitball. There's nothing they can do to speed up because they will be playing the fastest deck, main deck.
Yes. So
it's going to be different counter suites, possibly. There's a pattern negation maybe
inside.
High Tide
tends to run a wish board.
So there's
so
maybe only four slots?
Not very many sideboard cards. Yeah, something like four slots, which are probably something like Leyline. I'm not sure.
But the
though.
Problem with a wish board is a lot of people often bring those in the main deck because you've got so many more ways of finding them, your cantrips, and it's more mana efficient to preordain and brainstorm and ponder into your wish target's main deck.
Yes.
So he might well bring in some of those. I suspect.
I didn't see any of the cards that he was boarding in. Have you seen anything different?
That's a turnabout.
Surgical extraction.
He's brought in a surgical.
Excellent classic magic player thing. Fluster Storm. Okay.
I think we might have to actually just say it's a bad player thing now.
Just makes me sad.
I know.
I've had so many conversations where somebody says, yes, I've surgicaled your Path to Exiles. Now you can't kill my Tarmogoyfs. I've killed two of your Tarmogoyfs already. And now, I'm like, yeah. Anyway. He has a Counterspell in his deck. He has an Echoing Truth in his deck. Well, I don't know if he's a main deck or not.
It's kind of the classic... it's one of the classic things to talk about now in Legacy. You know, brainstorm, how to play a brainstorm, and how not
depends
to play
on
a
your
surgical.
Deck quite a lot.
Yeah, well, you know, let's
how not to play surgical. Don't bring it in unless your opponent is reliant on a specific set of cards to win the game or their graveyard.
I mean, it's omnipresent now. You look on MTG Goldfish and it's in 60% of decks.
Yes.
60+% of decks. It's mad.
Well, a lot of decks are Miracles, Checkpile, and Delver.
It shouldn't be in 60% plus of decks, though.
Probably not.
It's more prevalent than Brainstorm.
Is it?
Yes.
Is Brainstorm less than 60%?
Yes, on MTG That's Goldfish when you look crazy. At cards.
How many rounds are left? This is the round before last.
Yes, they're both 2-0. This is we play four rounds, and this is...
Oh, somebody won this game.
Three. Oh, it doesn't matter.
How do we do this?
So you go to Players and Games on the left there. Click up, Nico, and then click Save.
I'm a professional already.
Yeah. I like this this scoreboard assistant. It's very good.
It is.
So, shuffling up for round game two, Maxwell's going to have the advantage, I think, here, because he'll be on the play. I think it might actually be that simple, this game, this matchup.
Yeah, it might well be.
A play, draw, choice. But this is what the people wanted to see. But we've got a Force, some Probes, Deathrite, a Spell Piss.
He's got a land?
No land. Two Probes, though, would you keep?
Six as well. Six on two Probes, yeah, I keep.
You keep that? Yeah, and you're in the draw.
And you have a Force and turn one threats, and you're on the draw. Yeah, I'd
keep this.
Keep this,
yeah. Oh, he's done it. Good. Job.
And he's kept on the bottom.
he's
kept on the bottom. Yeah, good point.
Nearly put it back. Ponder. Land priority. Probably keeping this.
Merchant Scroll, yeah, I'd keep that.
He has a Force of Will.
He's playing this fast, Maxwell. For someone who's never played Legacy or
is that even doing Cleek?
Apparently.
Is a snap? A Candelabra, a Merchant Scroll, a Cleek, I believe, a Force, and a Delta. Miko drew Tropical Island, the worst land in the deck.
Better than no land, though.
Yeah.
Would you have snapped off both the probes now?
No.
Before you found the trop, would you have done one?
Oh, actually, no. I would have done one, because you want to find a daze.
Yeah.
Sorry. It's been a while. So you want to find daze, and you probably want to keep one for Force.
And if you drew a different land, you might want to play that.
Yeah, like a Volcanic Island, because you want to cast Pyroblast. Or an Underground Sea, because you want to attack your opponent.
I didn't see Pyroblast. I'm not sure yet.
That's Pyroblast.
Oh, yes, it's a foil Pyroblast, isn't it, from Modern Masters. That's the card that I
Eternal
was...
Eternal Masters.
Sorry, Masters. it was the set that... I can't be relied on to think of all these cards. Let's bring it up. I guarantee you that'll be the one, the Pyroblast, that comes up.
Oh, well, yeah. It's the most recent printing. I think that's how this is working. I think that'll still work.
Do you think a capital... All right, let's go with that.
That'll work.
Do you think...
I don't think it's case sensitive.
Do you think when you engage in thinking that Pyroblast you should be playing three of these, or should it be a split with 2-1 Red Blast?
Depends a lot.
What does it depend
on? Your deck configuration.
Okay.
If you're playing something, lots of cards that include Delve Spells.
Yeah.
Monster Mentor and Young Pyromancer, and Tarmogoyf.
Yeah.
And probably other ones that I'm missing. Pyroblast has the added benefit of you can cast it whenever you want to fuel Delve or make your Tarmogoyf bigger or to trigger your threats. However, this makes you weaker against cards like Surgical Extraction and Cabal Therapy. So you are balancing one against the other. And that depends on how many of those cards you might have in your deck at any one time.
Do you think this is a tangible...
You drew Wasteland.
You would have not had these in our deck. Do you think this is a tangible thing, though? Do you think that the playing around Cabal Therapy and Surgical?
Cabal Therapy, definitely, because... You tend to bring
or
in your...
In your deck building. But do you think that is a tangible choice that you can make? That you can see the difference in enough games?
Playing around Cabal Therapy with your three Pyroblasts?
Yes.
I have.
Right, no, it's in your... No. So let's say you're playing around... You're not playing around... You know, you're playing three Pyroblasts and therefore you're not playing around Cabal Therapy, are you? I'm saying, do you think you play enough games of Magic in your lifetime that will actually be... There'll be a... You know, a measurable difference with
measurable
with
yeah.
that consist with that
yeah
with that configuration.
I play too much Magic, but that has happened to me.
No, but I often think, you know, because we know that there's a best time to fetch a land and all this kind of stuff. And but are you ever going to play enough Magic to see that? You say yes.
I'd say yes. So Miko blasted Maxwell's draw step Vendilion Cleek.
I like that play.
Exiling Maxwell's fetch land from his graveyard. What's coming up now is... Threshold, another thing. What's coming up now is that if Miko wants another Color of Mana, he can Wasteland his own Wasteland and use Deathrow Shaman.
And it has come up, hasn't it? There we are.
I didn't think Wasteland would still be in the deck, though. But
and there's a Young Pyromancer.
And there is
I quite Pyromancer. Like playing that as soon as possible.
Yes. I do like blasting the cleat, though. This is round 3 or 4. Thank you, Darksphere Twitch bot. Or Alexi
or
from
Alexi,
afar.
Wherever you are.
I'm not sure where you are, Alexi. Although now forever to be known by your other name, Darksphere Twitch bot. Candelabra of Tornos.
So this is not the turn he's going off. He doesn't have the mana for it.
He can't. He casts High Tide if he wants to. It'd be quite interesting.
He doesn't have High Tide in hand.
His Snap, though, which is a fun card.
Oh, he's cast the High Tide. My apologies. It's already in the graveyard there.
So he's trying to go off on turn 3. And he's going to force back, I assume, pitching probably Scroll. Yeah, okay. So now he can snap a creature and untap 2 lands.
Yep.
What?
3 lands, in fact.
Oh, he's using his Candelabra now.
Yeah.
I actually think that's probably worse. That makes you less mana, right?
He needs to get to 7.
Yeah, but that's 6.
Oh, and he's keeping track of it. Thank you.
Time Spiral.
This you do 3? Something as well, Miko. Don't worry. Time Spiral is for both players. Yes, so there is the turn 3.
Time Spiral, a card not often cast.
He needed quite a lot of cards for that to actually happen. The Snap, as well as the Candelabra and the High Tide. All 3 were the way to make that
but
happen.
But with Miko's slightly clunky draw, it does look like Maxwell is getting an opportunity to go off. So we might see High Tide go off here.
So he's got 6 mana available right now.
Yes.
All his islands are making him 2.
He's going to draw 7 cards. 7.
Well, he'll find a High Tide, presumably.
Maybe just another Time Spiral. Is he tracking a Storm?
I don't think it matters, really.
Well, I mean, he probably does have Brain Freeze somewhere.
No, he'll be winning with Blue Sun Zenith. That's the traditional win condition.
I think you have both.
Because you can Blue Sun yourself to draw to
don't
get
you
going.
Want access to both? I'm not sure. What's this? Meditate. So that's 3 mana, draw 4?
Maybe this is, that's the...
He's not tapping his land, so he must have had floating mana.
Okay. And there is the high tide. High tide, so they make 3 now.
He's just casting spells without paying for them, it looks like.
He apparently keeps his mana floating verbally, someone told me. So it makes it a bit harder for us to guess what's going on.
Really? He's just, I suppose there's only one colour.
But yes, yeah, it is, yeah. This man has played this deck a lot, it looks like.
I think he has.
Do you think he has...
I think he's lying when he's saying he's not played this deck before.
Do you think he's played it at home many, 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 many times against himself?
Maybe. I mean, I have done that with Storm decks before. But
maybe you've got no life. Maxwell is a...
I mean, you might be correct there, but I'm loath to admit it. I spent an awful lot of my time with these people.
This game is all over, but for the singing or whatever the phrase is.
I think, Miko is 100% dead.
Well, Miko might have a force. He might have drawn into another force, but Maxwell's going to keep drawing until he finds more forces.
On
Flusters
the Fluster Storm, Merchant Scroll, Merchant Scroll. Are
the Flusters main? The Flusters must be main.
Don't know. Is he going to get Cunning Wish or Blue Sun Zenith? Yeah, he has Cunning Wishes in his deck, sure.
I like that Magic exists and you can play decks like this that are...
Yes, this is really interesting.
Slightly... the building of this deck must have been great fun to be one of the people who iterated this deck. You know.
So we're going to see Capsize with Buyback on a Candelabra here.
Ooh, right, that's a lot of mana. And there's the Cunning Wish.
Oh, maybe
and there's the concession.
Oh.
He's saying, I've got the Cunning Wish, I can just keep going.
Oh, he didn't do it. I wanted him to capsize all his opponent's permanents after making infinite mana. Alright, well, we're on to game 3.
Oh. On to game 3.
Oh. Where is the thing?
It's up here. Players and games.
Okay.
This interaction between you and I is, I think, the height of the stream.
I think I'm better at the card lookup and you're better at this.
Yes, yeah. That's well, you know, here we are. We work together. We should have a different card there. The Pyroblast didn't come in handy. Time Spiral? No, that's his name. Francis.
His name is now Cunning Wish. I can't remember his name. Hang on. The there art of the anticlimax. What, just giving up when you've already won?
There we go.
So, can you tell me what species of animal that is?
Oh God, I thought I could. Is it one of those crab peoples?
Is it going to have breakfast soon?
You think it's a cephalid?
Or a cephalid.
Cephalid.
It might be a cephalid. I think it is a cephalid.
Is that a gin?
Antitatema thinks it's calamari.
Is that a gin, though, on the left?
On the left?
He's got a very Arabian beard, but he's blue. So
yeah,
makes
I think that's
think
Robin
he's a
Williams.
Genie or a gin.
Robin Williams, definitely.
I was thinking it might be one of those homerids.
Homerids? Homerid shaman? I think that's a favorite of... Yeah, you can try and spell that, I guess. I don't think that's how you spell it, but we can try. I think it's an...
Oh!
So, I think this card is on the reserve list.
Well, with the
Stuart Taylor might have said that a few times on some podcast somewhere.
With
Legacy Breakfast, shout
knowledge.
Out to Legacy Breakfast. Homerid Shaman has made an appearance.
God, that's a good card. Look at that. What does it do? Tap a target green creature.
What doesn't it do? Oh, I've got a hashtag buyout Ophidian. Yes, I've got a favorite actually. This is a favorite of mine. I actually don't know. Ooh, can I put this on stream or is this slightly inappropriate?
I don't know.
We'll have a look. This card is a classic from Magic's golden era.
Oh, what is going on there? Sixth edition was not the golden era, Francis.
Look at this creature.
Three mana, untapped target creature. Wow.
Rude the flavor toast.
I've been insulted by drunks in 100 inns, but never as skillfully or annoyingly as by these blasted brownies. Well, I think it is a... It's a sprite, isn't it? Like the Wii...
Clearly says creature brownie.
The Wii Aeronauts.
Which I believe is a cake, but, you know. Right.
It's going to be from like Irish mythology.
Let's put a card that's in these players' decks on there because they've started playing again. Underground Sea in play and anything interesting. Let's put Hate's Control wants more of the brownie creature type. I do too.
Ah, Tornos, yes.
This crowd.
Stop pressing enter.
I feel like that should be obvious. That should work.
I know. Okay, so here's the Cabal Therapy.
Sorrow's Path.
What do you think he's named?
Brainstorm.
You think he's named Brainstorm?
Yes.
I think he's going to have named High Tide or Candle Orb.
Why?
Because the brainstorms don't matter that much.
Can you say that again?
The brainstorms don't matter that much.
You've heard it here, ladies and gentlemen.
No, but his deck is redundant with cantrips.
Brainstorms don't matter in Legacy.
Yep, sell them all now. We don't need them.
You might as well just play Sleight of Hand. He missed, so he didn't name Candelabra.
He didn't name the cards I wanted him to name.
Any way of finding out? So I'd quite like to know what he named now.
Mm.
Ophidian would name Brainstorm a Cunning Wish. Notably, Ophidian wouldn't name Ophidian.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a miss, isn't it, really?
I mean, I would name Ophidian. It's a great card.
Miko's hands are just not lining up correctly, are they?
Miko has a Delver, doesn't he?
No.
Is that a Flusterstorm?
That's a Flusterstorm, yeah. Would you have played the second Therapy there? Or at least brainstormed for some kind of... What's going on?
I've had some instructions from Minhajul Hawk. I probably should be ignoring, but I'm not.
Yeah, you really should. you're on this right now.
All right. Gosh.
God, I'm being professional.
I'm being blasted by my elder here.
He's being unprofessional. Elder and better looking. Let's just be honest there.
Okay, fine.
So, let's be right. He should have played the Brainstorm, I think, last turn and found and searched for some gas or used the Cabal Therapy.
You should have played something last
turn. Yeah, rather than passing with two mana open and doing instant speed. He can't... Maxwell
his deck
can't
is all
win
sorcery
on
speed,
on
essentially. He doesn't have two instant speed counter spells.
Yeah, but Maxwell can't win on turn two, so you can tap out there for a Delver, right?
Yes. If he had Flusterstorm, he might have wanted to have Brainstorm for extra storm count.
That's weak.
I just...
I mean, you are tiny in the pitch there, so they can't see that you're looking at your phone.
from being professional. Apparently, I posted a bunch of cats.
Oh, is your phone is
right
pressing stuff
in my pocket? Yeah. Right. Okay. Anything happening here? Polluted Delta. Some would say the best land in Magic.
This is the time to be casting this Cabal Therapy.
Right, he's not doing anything. Why hasn't he cast Therapy? He knows his opponent's hand.
He needs to, yeah.
Tiny and low res. Thank you, Cracky Senior. Except I know your name is not that, but you know.
Is that the Welsh chap that doesn't
That's
like you?
George Moulton.
Oh, is it really? Oh.
I don't know why you're so pleased.
No, I was just thinking it might be somebody who could back up all the gobbiness.
Cabal Therapy. Oh, and Maxwell's found a brainstorm.
Too late. Two turns too late.
Classic sexy therapies. They are indeed. Those are,
they are beautiful.
The best therapies.
Well, there's that and Graveborn, so that's definitely the best one.
I mean, I have those ones, but without the bits of metal all over them. But
I'd like a foil card of that era is very nice.
Your conversation about cutting brainstorm. Again, Minifer, stop swearing.
We've not talked about cutting brainstorm.
I did.
Did you?
Yeah. You said that brainstorm isn't very good, so I said people might as well cut it.
Oh, right. Okay.
I mean, they could play other cards like Homeroid Shaman.
No, I'm just saying that I think that High Tide is probably the deck where brainstorm is used to its least.
Cracky Scene is upset.
Yep.
Well, I think Brainstorm did a good job there, right? He missed on his therapy. Or is it resolving? Or is he flustering it? Or what?
But you know what I mean, right? This deck is all four of us. What's that music going on?
That's an ice cream van somewhere.
Was it your phone or my phone? Oh, no. So I think it's the Morrowind theme tune we're listening to.
Sorry?
Is this the Morrowind theme tune we're listening to?
They asked for Skyrim.
Ah, Skyrim.
It's the same song. So
okay, we've worked out what the music is. The Skyrim theme is being played.
So they can't hear our loud voices.
Somebody in the room watching us on stream.
They could just look at our faces over here.
We are just sat here, but apparently that's all right.
It's probably to... Oh, look.
Miko's deciding to use his... Oh, look, that other thing I talked about. If you leave in your wastelands versus a basic deck...
There's nothing on the stack here. Oh, but he's forcing the wasteland to shuffle away the brainstorm. That's what he's doing.
Apparently I should show Tom something. Min, you're being very disruptive. TC decks. Apparently this is 18 plus content.
Get Min to PM me.
Min, I don't like that you're sending me 18 plus content.
Yeah, that does that, or TC decks. If he PMs me, I can.
Oh, I see. I mean, I'm not really looking forward to watching 18 plus content.
So what do you think about this then? He chose not to shuffle. He chose not to fetch. He's lost the land.
Clearly, Miko made a soul read and didn't board out his wastelands and did this thing. Yeah.
Well, he had the lands in hand already. He didn't need them. He needs four to win. He needs the cards on top.
Yeah, there's no clock. Maxwell's still on 20.
It's a real shame, this.
I think Miko's dead.
Yes, me too. I think he needs to use his therapies much more aggressively.
I don't know why he's...
Two in a turn.
Yeah. Franza still looks like he should be at school. Wow. Tom Cadden. Smack talk. Already.
I mean...
All right.
I don't want to say anything. I'm just listening to the beautiful Skyrim music.
I like Skyrim.
It's a good game.
I mean... Skyrim and Morrowind do have the same music.
They do. They've got the same theme tunes, yeah. I liked Oblivion the most.
I preferred Oblivion.
Is that the one you played first?
No, I played Morrowind first.
Oh, okay. Because often I feel that people with those kind of like seminal childhood games, you prefer the one you played first.
They both need to be warned for slow play. I know. They really should be, because all we're doing is discussing the Morrowind theme, and that's not... Yeah,
yeah, it's a shame, isn't it? Well, the thing is, we're disagreeing so strongly with Miko's plays, and he's playing the interactive deck, so...
He's got a force, and he has... Was that a fluster?
Yeah.
I think he's got a fluster. I think he's had a fluster in hand since turn one. He could have flustered the brainstorm. Oblivion sucked. Cracky Senior is quite mouthy.
He is, yeah.
Hmm.
Okay, so it's past the turn. All right, let's find some action, Miko, and we can get
Miko's casting.
Forces would be nice here, something
and then
like that.
Just end of turn brainstorm again. What was probe? Well, you know, a delver, or just anything.
He's just been unlucky.
Go, guys. Thanks, oh, Dead Earnest.
Thanks.
How honest of you.
So those candelabras.
No, the brainstorm goes to your graveyard, Miko. It doesn't go back in your hand.
Where's it got? What?
He cast brainstorm. And he went to put it back in his hand.
Oh, okay.
After he resolved
you can,
it.
You can be, you know, stressed on camera.
That'd be great. Brainstorm with buyback zero. How do you feel about that card?
I mean, I think it's probably fair. So what's the price of a candelabra at the moment?
I don't know. 400 quid or something?
No, it's much. It's got to be more than that.
I haven't. I don't think I've ever looked up how much a candelabra costs.
4 years ago, I was offered a playset for £1,000.
Do you think now it'll be more?
100% it'll be more, yes.
Right, I'm going to look this up.
400 is a good guess, though, isn't it? I don't see it being played in old school, so...
I'm assuming it's reserve list.
Yes, yeah. It's antiquities. That's on the battlefield, Miko. You can't take the candelabra.
$600, so about £400. Although if you want to... No. Prices vary a lot. There aren't very many available.
Yes, that's going to be the thing, isn't it?
Yeah, it's about $600, though.
Okay, cool. Oh, we've got 100-plus viewers. Wonderful. I'm glad.
Hooray!
Everyone,
hello, 100-plus people. What? I'm looking up the prices of candelabra of Tornos for you. Well, I hope you're enjoying it.
Well, welcome to London. Welcome to Legacy at Darksphere. I hope you're enjoying these games. We've had, unfortunately, some reasonably uninteractive games. That's just been a bit of bad luck, really.
There was a wonderful match between Burn and Miracles. This game
well,
is
that
just
had some play in it, though.
This game is going very slowly, and that's the main problem here. If these people sped up, it might be more interesting.
It's because France is a millennial and therefore has no attention span.
Yes.
Yeah.
Let's go with that. I mean, I don't have an attention span. I am aware of this. I get very bored very quickly. But you know,
those underground seas are very different in terms of colour. But there's two different printings.
Underground sea.
There's the Paris colours for betas or something like that. I think it's called. People who are really into alpha and beta stuff know.
Well, even revised seas have different colours.
They have very different colours, yes. And then one set's called Paris colours, and I'm not sure what the other set are called. But
My set don't match.
Miko's cards will be real.
Oh, yeah, Miko's cards are real. I'm not worried about that.
You need some D&T. Well, I think George might be right. D&T often is quite an interactive deck and has a lot of play.
Except he's specifically requesting sick D&T, and I don't think that exists.
I've never heard such a thing. Maybe it's the red version. There's people who've been playing that, haven't they? With
the red...
Pier and Kian Lar?
No, with the 2-mana Snapcaster your graveyard card.
Oh, the new card that I have never heard of, that one.
You not heard of that?
Yeah, well, I saw it at the Snapcaster thing, but like...
People are playing it.
There's two of those, but Pier and Kian Lar is much more interesting in my opinion.
Ugh, no, D&T players are the same kind of people that whiteboarded their entire decks. Nobody likes D&T players. Thanks, Ophidian.
So this game has gone on longer than we thought, and here's the cleek again.
All right.
Is he going to cleek himself?
So the High Tide... No, High Tide's been countered. He's casting been dealing cleek. Miko has double force, Fossil Storm, Spell Pierce. So I don't think... Okay, no forces left. Dead Earnest is requesting Tyless Tribe. I couldn't agree more. I love Tyless Tribe.
Is that a daze? I can't. That's a foil thing that I've never seen before. Cunning Wish, possibly.
What, in Maxwell's hand?
Yeah. Is that a?
I doubt it's a daze. It's probably a Cunning Wish.
Is that one of the new ones? No. The Cunning Wish hasn't been reprinted.
No.
It's an invocation.
It's a turnabout. Oh. I can't tell what that is.
Counterspell.
It's a pact invocation.
It's counterspell.
It's just counterspell.
Just actual counterspell. So he brought one of those in there.
I think he has another one with a different art. I think he has a whiteboarded one. Yeah! Tom Cadden's confirmed my reserve list price guessing skills.
You are one. Oh, and he left the Gurmags in.
Yeah.
This game has gone long enough for Gurmag to be relevant, hasn't it?
I don't think it should have done, though.
No.
Someone should be dead by now. We're both just watching two decks just sort of flail at each other
It's a little ships passing in the night, which is another nice metaphor for the High Tide deck. Because that is essentially what that deck wants to do.
Ooh, another Time Spiral. You love drawing two of those, don't you?
Well, he just needs...
A High Tide, and he can go off
high
with...
High Tide, yeah. And he wins.
But it got countered, I think.
Is this where the Surgical's actually good?
If he Surgical's High Tide, that's quite
good. You counter and then Surgical, but you're relying on that, aren't you?
But now the Angler is in play.
Why are you not attacking with it?
You might want to block the Candelabra. Cracky Senior's telling us that the card's called Dire Fleet Instigator. Sounds familiar.
Yes, that is the two mana red
Miko
one.
Has decided that attacking with Gurmag Angler is a good mode. Like Force that. Of Will.
We can talk about if that card's going to be good in Legacy.
All right, well, we can bring that up after the match. It's definitely not in either of these decks. Flusterstorm Storm is getting eaten. I think this game's over, though.
Well, I can't.
If Maxwell draws High Tide this turn, oh no, that was his turn.
No. Miko has plenty of counters.
So yeah. Now he's turnabouting, countering his creatures, but he's going to Flusterstorm it or something. Pierce, Force, Flusterstorm.
Use the blue, Miko.
Flusterstorm it.
Win the game.
You have a what? Cast Flusterstorm. Yep, with your Volcanic Island. Yeah, boy. You got it. And that is the end of the game. Attack. Drain for two.
Oh, wonderful. Congratulations to Miko. We thought he should be winning that. That last game was quite an odd one. Mm-hmm. So let's go back to the booth and let's find out what this Dire Fleet Instigator is called. Or what is the card? Maybe Dire Fleet's one word?
Mm. I think it's a hyphen.
You think it's a hyphen?
Yeah. Or George is just lying.
Yeah, well, he's been known for that in the past. Nope, no hyphen.
Dire Fleet Daredevil. Maybe that one. That's right. You can watch our stream where we guess the names of magic cards that don't exist.
Francis, bigging us up again. Okay. That's wonderful.
Jaina, you're also wrong.
Let's just give up on that.
No hyphen two words, says Cracky Senior.
Oh, right. So the brain trust over in chat managed to work it out.
Well, maybe. We haven't improved.
Aha! Hey, round of applause for chat there.
Well, round of applause for Jaina 87.
Okay, so.
Oh, USA Wolfchain.
Hello.
Is here.
Welcome to the.
Say hello.
Welcome to the stream. That's a very sexy hello from there. You didn't like flirting, and there you go, flirting.
Well, it's USA Wolf Chan. Yeah, I don't know what you're going to say.
It's got first strike. Is that it's flash, yeah?
Almost, yeah.
Enter the battlefield. Okay, so it's exactly the same, but you can cast it. You get mana for it as well.
It's not exactly the same, actually.
The cast is slightly different. Are you being a classic?
It doesn't give the spell flashback.
Awful
it
magic
actually
player.
Means you can cast it from a graveyard, like Jace Fringe Prodigy.
Does it go
so
back to
the
graveyard?
So you can use alternate custom costs, like you can return islands to your hand, like Gush.
And you can use Force.
Yes, by exiling a card from your hand, and you can pay the overload cost on Cyclonic Rift.
Okay, so it's slightly different. Is this going to come up?
You saw exactly the same. So.
is there a four snapcaster for this card deck?
No.
No.
You can play it in Death and Taxes. I think people have been trying that. Not sure if it's good. I haven't seen it or played against it or watched anyone play with it.
I mean, it has flash if you have Aether Vial, right?
Exactly, and flash and first strike.
It's pretty good.
You can ambush their snapcaster mage with your Aether Vial.
It's the build your own ambush viper.
You can play it and target a counter spell to protect one of your future spells.
Yes. Yeah, that's a good
other
point.
Other weird things.
It's probably just a bit of value, isn't it, in the deck?
It's probably just casts Brainstorm or Lightning Bolt or Reanimate on their Grizzlebrand or...
I mean, you don't want to be casting their Instance or Sorceress, though. You're a Thalia deck, right?
I wouldn't say no to reanimating a Grizzlebrand.
Oh, all right then. That seems like a corner case. Doesn't it seem perhaps better, slightly better in the kind of removal mirrors or where they've got removal?
Free Brainstorm, free Lightning Bolt. you bolt their Delver and you make a 2-1.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It's better disgusting. At using removal on their creatures that are blocking your Batterskull or whatever it is.
Yeah. No, Bob wins games except in Sneak and Show.
I don't really understand what they're talking about.
You could play Snap or Torrential Gear Hulk. Torrential Gear Hulk?
Oh, well, you could play many cards, right?
Tempted to play it in Teemo Moon in Modern. Not the same card, but...
What's Teemo Moon?
I think they're talking about Rug Blood Moon.
That seems like a really bad deck.
I think I've played against this deck.
Really? Okay. Tell me more about this three-colored deck.
It has
Blood
cards
Moon.
Like Tireless Tracker and Tarmogoyf.
Okay, so it's got value green cards. I like the sound of that.
And Snapcaster Mage.
Yeah, okay, cool card.
And Cryptic Command.
Right.
And Spell Pierce.
All right.
And Blood Moon.
Hmm.
Now, I know what you're thinking. Blood Moon might be a bit counterintuitive.
What am I thinking? Yeah, well, yeah.
Especially that. In a Cryptic Command three-color deck.
Yeah, I was. Those were actually the thoughts
and
I was
would
having.
Agree.
Okay. Is the deck awful? And these are all really good
I've
cards.
I've only played against it once.
Okay. It lost?
Yeah.
Did it lose badly?
Yep.
Were you playing, say, Grixis Death Shadow thing?
No, I was playing... Blue, white, red control.
Oh, okay, so you just count stuff.
With win conditions being Snapcaster Mage and Celestial Colonnade. I didn't
like
even
cards.
Have a Torrential Gear Hulk.
I'm always surprised by how much Celestial Colonnade is costs.
It's really good.
Yeah, but it's so expensive.
It is very
to buy,
expensive.
Like the card.
I did trade like duels for the modern deck, so.
I was opening those at Zendikar, and I'm still surprised about how, you know, how much they cost.
I don't know. It's not been reprinted. It's really good.
It's a buy a box promo.
Cryptic Command and Huntmaster of the Fells. That's another card that was in that deck.
Ooh, well, it's got a lot of value, isn't it? But it sounds like it might be better without the moons. Are they
yeah,
on the sideboard?
Well, you know, no main.
Right, okay.
Main deck, Blood Moon, in your Cryptic Command deck.
But you've got to play basics then, haven't you? You're playing.
Well, you don't. You don't have to. No one's making you play them. You could just cast Blood Moon
the
and
idea
then
is
never
that
cast any of your spells.
Your Blood Moon wins against their.
You know what? You might want to play instead of it. I want to play Blood Sun.
That might be a better card.
Because then you could still cast your spells.
Yes.
Maybe. I mean, you might draw fetch lines. But, you know.
But at least you can cast your spells. But then your opponent can as well. Is Blood Moon that just that much of a lockout in Modern? I mean, I don't really
Blood
play Blood
Moon's good against
anymore.
Tron.
Yeah.
Shadow.
Okay. Seems a bit slow for Shadow. Shadow.
Yeah, but if you kill two of their creatures and then play Blood Moon, then...
Killing two of the creatures is great enough. isn't that good enough?
Yeah, but they can call against Command and back and cast that Custom Age.
Okay, all right. I don't
Shadow's
know.
Quite resilient. It's not very good against lots of things, though, like, you know, Storm or Burn.
As Terra here, so I'm afraid, having disagreed with Terra many a time in this chat, I finally come round to their way of thinking. Blood Moon is now being played in Jund. Isn't Modern great? I mean, yes, it sounds wonderful.
Modern is actually quite fun at the moment.
Really?
Normally I don't enjoy it, but over the last couple of months... I've really liked it, so.
I can play Lantern in Modern, can't I?
Yeah. You can play it in Legacy as well if you want.
I have played Lantern in Modern, actually. It was quite fun.
Some people think that's fun. I think it's quite fun. I like that exists. Some people, whenever Lantern comes on stream, lots of people get very, very angry.
Why? It's good that Prison exists. That was a pillar of the fort.
I don't think
the
it's good that Prison
made.
Exists.
I think it should.
But I think it's... Well, I don't mind. I don't mind either way that it exists or not. I like that it's strategically diverse. I think what was happening was there was a Burn versus like Lantern deck on stream, and the chat was screaming that the Lantern deck was horrible, whilst
the
Burn deck,
all
they were doing was like, oh, you
Lightning
take three,
bolting, yeah.
You take three more, you take four, I win. Whereas the Lantern deck was doing all these sweet things with like weird artifacts and... Witchbane Orb and like
Worm
Invention. I was like, this deck's sweet.
And
why
main
would
deck
you
Surgicals
this?
For a reason.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's a deck where they're good. And you know, you've got win conditions of not decking yourself and stuff like that.
Cracky Senior says, get Alex Ray's story about Spyglass. He just posted on Facebook.
All right, well, maybe have a look and then we'll read out the story.
I can look him up, yeah. How is Callum getting on after his shocker last week?
Alex.
Don't know, he lost a Burn, so.
What story have you got? What story about Spyglass? What's your story about Spyglass?
Turn one, he's Spyglass to me, and I've got three boosted
Deltas. Oh, that's not that good then. All right.
So the story is turn one Spyglass, and he has 3 Polluted Deltas and 0 other fetches. So
that was interesting.
I thought
Thank
it was going to be a bit better than that, George.
Thank you, George. Excellent content for everybody involved.
Please come back and watch this again.
Lantern is not fun to play against, but neither are decks like Burn and Boggles. Exactly. Magic's apparently a zero-sum game. I don't know if it's next round yet.
Well, if you're not having fun, then your opponent can't be having fun.
We still have one match on time.
Yep, I
recognise. Which is why we're just rambling for no reason, really.
No, we're not rambling for no reason. People are getting value out of listening to us slag off Modern.
Well, I'm saying I like it. But
yeah, I'm being very quiet about how awful it is.
I cast Sphinx's Revelation for 6 a lot last weekend.
Oh, that would be great. So that would be good, yeah. I disagree with these comments, like, you know, that these things are not fun to play against. Some people might enjoy them. Some people don't enjoy what you enjoy.
Boggles is fun to play against when you play 2 Runehalers and you name both of their threats.
I know, we don't. But the thing
That's
is,
great.
We don't all eat the same food. We don't all, you know, enjoy the same things. The world would be a very boring place if we all enjoyed the same things.
Exactly. If we were all Tom Kellogg, it would be awful.
I don't know.
Was that a cool story, bro? It was indeed a cool story, bro.
Yeah, it really was.
Romario Vidal. I recognise that name.
Yeah, Romario's...
he plays online.
Plays a lot online and does a bit of streaming himself. Hello, watches Romario. My stream. He's a lovely chap.
You might know who I am. I don't know.
This is Francis Cowper. It says underneath.
How to play Miracles. Yeah, cool. So, get really good at casting cantrips faster than you can think. Tip 1. So you have to look at your cards, put them back immediately. Then you don't piss anyone off when you're playing the deck. Sorry for swearing, but lots of people get very annoyed.
I don't think piss is a swear word.
Yeah, but
no,
I'm not in charge.
No, it's a descriptive term.
Descriptive term. People get very cross when you play Miracles because you're slow. So tip 1, play fast. That's all I'm going to say.
Okay, what about like the basic tips of you should be using your cantrips to find lands? That seems like the basic...
If you don't have any lands?
No, the first person... Oh, cry out loud. Am I getting blood from a stone?
How to play Miracles well, be pedantic.
Yeah, possibly. Well, or how to be a typical Magic player. Pedantry.
Pedantry is a very excellent term.
And that was me being a pedant.
Tip 2,
it.
Always hit the blind flips with counterbalance. There we go, KJ. Yeah, that's correct.
Okay, so I've never played Miracles before.
You've never played Miracles before?
No, I'm pretending. You've lent me the deck. Right. What piece of advice are you going to give me on going into the tournament? You've got 5 minutes. You've got 5 minutes to give me some advice. And I, you know.
The Force of Will, there, Chalice of the Void.
Right, come on, be serious, all right? You want me to win? You
Fetch
know,
your basics.
Pretend like we're friends. Fetch my basics, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, it looks like we're going to be coming back for the round 4 in a minute.
So
we'll see you in a sec.
See you about a
we could turn this camera around, it's just people all the way in this giant,
will take
this is a great
this
card
and
store.
Tweet it out in a minute, guys, because this is amazing.
Yes, and if you're in the London area, I cannot recommend enough for people to come down to Dark Sphere. You know, at GP London, so many people who did not know I was coming down here simply said to me, you should check out Dark Sphere while you're here, and began singing the praises not only of the store and its selection, but of the people playing here. And I really can confirm both that this store is amazing. We walked in, it's just all the wonderful nerd stuff that we love, and it's a great sight to see. But the people and the crowd in here, I'm actually feeling a little overwhelmed by the sense of community, and everybody's hanging out. And you know, whenever I see, I've been at events where I see people lose and they look sour and they're upset, and I'm seeing people, they're laughing so hard with their friends and making friends. And I'm seeing, I came down here with a buddy who hasn't been in here before, and he's already made five friends and chatting, and it's such a great atmosphere. So if you are in the area, and not an endorsement, yeah. I shill for Card Kingdom, not Dark Sphere, so you know I'm telling the truth when I say that Dark Sphere is a fantastic place. And if you are in the area or you're visiting, come on down and check it out, because I'm so glad that I did.
Thank you very much. That's lovely to hear. And yeah, Monday night is always Pauper. We have Pauper Leagues on. They're run by, it's not even run by the store. It's run by members of the community. It's a labor of love. The people love this format. Mm-hmm. If you want to come down for Legacy or Modern, see Dark Sphere's website. But thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you very much for being here and for talking to us and for enjoying this, because
well,
this
thanks
is
for having me, because this is you and your store and your community putting this out here, and I just got to come by and see it, so I'm very happy. So look at what you all did out here. It's fantastic.
Thank you very much.
Hello, everybody.
Hi there.
And welcome back to the booth.
So we've got Tom Brown, or Tomb, as everyone likes to call him.
Tomb, yes. He's pretty old, getting ancient.
Tom B.
And Tom Brown is playing a deck called Miracle Control, whilst his opponent, Stuart Schaum, is playing, I believe, Black-Red Reanimator.
This is a shocking matchup for Black-Red Reanimator, so it might be a quick one. And we'll have a second match if we find one out after that.
There may be an upset, but
Yeah, I'd expect Miracles to win. That's my prediction. I'm not going to go against you on that.
This is where chat can learn about how to play.
Maybe they can.
No! Stop pressing! Stop it, you! God, he's so annoying.
Okay, what card should we look at?
I think Chancellor of the Annex is the most important card in this matchup.
Chancellor of the Annex. I didn't press enter.
You didn't. You did well. We've learned. It's 3 hours later.
All right. So Stu is using a Rogue to play Magic, and Tom Brown is using the London Eternal playmat.
Well, he's representing Magic card market there. Look at that. I think that's the most ugly playmat. But
you can't believe like that these two have only been playing Magic this century. Oh, when did you start playing?
95. So
yeah, I'm gonna say you've been playing for ages. I've only been starting playing this decade, but you know.
Yeah, no, I started in 95. I didn't stop for very many years. I started again in 2010. But I do have cards from 4th edition or 5th edition. Is that 96 maybe?
Tom Brown
Tom,
has a device at the table.
Get your phone off the screen or you'll get...
DQ'd. Island, Terminus, Island, Jace.
Those islands, are
Portent.
They're not Guru, are they? I'm very
no,
confused
they're
that.
Like Onslaught.
Ah, okay.
Entry. He's mulliganing his hand.
Showing us all.
I agree.
Very good of him.
He knows the matchup, so... You don't think you've either beat either of us? I can't remember.
Well, hopefully when London Legacy comes back, then you'll be able to come down, Tom.
I do play too much Magic. It's probably a problem.
I don't think you can... you can play too much, can't you, if the rest of your life suffers. But
Stuart
Tom,
has kept hands.
Tom and Stuart are firm friends, really old friends. They've been in each other for, 10, 12 years, probably.
Yeah. Phil is also saying, yep, right.
It's good to see Phil
Tom's scrying. He's putting on bottom.
Keeping on the bottom.
He hasn't got a Force of Will, I don't think, but he has got a Brainstorm. Now, Stu is casting in Tomb.
Oh, yeah, Stuart likes foil signed cards as well.
Yeah,
just
Stuart has
so
lovely cards too.
Is
Miracles the more popular deck here? I think Miracles is probably one of the top two decks in London. It's either Goblins or Miracles.
I don't. Well, Lands has been on the up for recently, hasn't it? But people have
Callum.
Stopped. Well, there was Joseph. There was maybe when I was last playing, maybe 6 months ago, properly.
There was a point in where Lands was the when I came to London, Lands was the most played deck.
Yeah,
and it was quite entertaining because I'd never really played against it before.
It's a good deck. The
this is a good deck.
The thing in London, I think, is enough people were lending cards, enough people are borrowing cards, and enough people have base to move around to change decks. People don't generally just play the same deck every week.
Yeah, you can play what you want most of the time.
You can often borrow what you need, and you've got the option to to play something funny next week.
One Guru, one APAC. What do you think? Why?
I don't think Tom has.
Tom's
a
lands
a
are Onslaught. I know they are.
A Guru.
Apart from the Misty Rainforest, obviously.
So what's going on here? I can't really see what's going on.
I think
is Tom
Stu
thinking
is entombing.
About this? Or is Stuart thinking...
What is he... Does Tom have Force? No. Okay.
Okay, I'm going to have to get the graveyard.
Tom's thinking about what he wants to do on turn one. He's deciding he's going to play as Misty Rainforest, which I deem to
Shall
be...
Shall I go and find get Stuart's graveyard
I deem that
the
to
screen.
Be correct.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be quite good. So I think Tom playing Misty Rainforest here is correct, because he has a Brainstorm and a Predict, and he will probably want to cast Brainstorm to counter this Exhume by finding a Force of Will, and then... He can get a Tundra with this, and then he will have an island which he can play to use as Predict without cracking a fetch land. Yay, Miracles. Yep. So now we can see that Grizzlebrand was the choice, which is, should be to no one's surprise. So Tom is doing what I think he is doing, so he's going to cast Brainstorm, and he is looking for a Force of Will.
I had a great game of Magic against Stuart once when he was playing Reanimator. He reanimated my Tireless Tracker, then got lots of value off it, and killed me with it. It was
sweet,
spectacular.
That's great. Tom choosing to pitch Jace, one of the better cards against Black Red, actually.
Yeah.
But he's probably playing three,
So now Tom can play his island and keep up Predict, which he can do because he cracked his Fakland. Oh, very nice. I like all of these things quite a lot. So, you know, there we are.
Guys, he's...
Once again, we found out that Taroy is playing Sneak and Show again.
Well, yeah, if I had to guess what deck Tara...
He's already told us.
...always was playing, I would guess Sneak and Show.
Okay, so what are the chances that Tom Brown has left a white card on top of his deck? Because he has Predict in hand. Say, yeah. Sweet.
He's playing well.
Two cards.
He's not letting the pressure get to him.
Two another card. No, I think Tom's pretty good. Contrary to all of our insults, Tom can play Magic.
No, but that's
I think he found a Force of Will, though.
His downfall is often the...
He's casting Counterbalance.
Playing
okay.
too quickly and being feeling under pressure and therefore making mistakes.
So Stu has got a blue splash in his black-red deck. Maybe he has Show and Tell, or maybe he's playing Careful Study.
I think it'll be Show and Tell from the sideboard.
So Stu chose to not to do anything, either because he couldn't.
He's been very unlucky here drawing all his lands, because I don't think he actually searched up many more than he's got on the battlefield there. Should be another couple of bad lands and a swamp, and that's it.
You might not even have the second swamp.
So we should start thinking about the sideboard.
Yeah, I think Tom might have won. Tom has a Jace.
This seems rather premature, possibly.
If Tom casts Jace, he has Force of Will in hand, I believe. He has a counterbalance in play. The card that he cares about if he casts Jace is Tidespout Tyrant, and that's it.
I've lost that card so many times.
That's basically it. Now Grizzlebrand doesn't beat him. I think this is basically it. And this is why Miracles is so good against Black Red, is that you can answer all of their threats, and you can just run them out of cards. They have to essentially have an unbeatable board state on turn one or two, or your cards just sort of push them over.
Mm. It's that Plow, often.
Yeah, Plow, or just a Terminus. And then Counterbalance starts sort of accruing value. Yeah, Tom got quite lucky to find the fourth off the brainstorm.
Yes, he did, yeah. This has been a very different game.
Otherwise, he would have just lost.
Well, not necessarily.
Probably.
Because he had the Terminus hanging around there, didn't he?
He did, yeah. He had a Terminus on top of his deck and a Tundra in play. But
this is the matchup where you want to be playing Blue-Black. Blue-Black, yeah. Because you can Daze and Force back.
You can Grizzlebrand into your Counter Magic, yeah.
I think Tom should invest in those nice metal dice that have the numbers written on for Planeswalkers.
Would that be good for the stream?
It would be good for the stream, and I think it would be good for the soul.
I see, okay. Well, you can recommend that to Tom.
I will.
Yeah, I don't see Tom losing this game.
Well, let's speculate how he loses.
Tidespout Tyrant into play.
Is that the only method? There isn't another line here. He's playing a Brainstorm off the top of the screen there. I'm going to tell them.
He's playing a Portent on his opponent.
Is he really?
Yes.
I can't see what's going on.
No, I can't either, but he's messing around with his opponent's deck. There are very few cards that let you do that. And
this is why I describe you as a Miracles Master.
This is a suspicion. I don't know how good this play is. Stu has two fetch lands in play, so this is a relatively low value play. And Portent is... Yeah, well, like, what's he doing? Okay, I find all this odd.
This is the kind of thing that we were talking about. Possibly overthinking or playing too quickly.
He should just be holding his cantrips. He can Fate Seal and force Stu to crack his fetches that way. And he can use his cantrips to set up his counterbalance. Mm. And then afterwards, he can start portenting his opponent once Stu's used his fetch lands. Of course, this is dependent on his hand and lots of things, but you know, it's quite likely he has some Snapcaster Mage for his predict. So knowing the top card of a library, it's, you know.
So So at the sideboard, are we thinking we're going to see some show and tells?
I'd expect so, because I expect Tom has 3 surgical extractions in the sideboard.
Yeah.
But he does have Flusser Storms, and he might bring in some blasts, knowing that Stu is on blue cards. So he's fetched. He's going to cast Grave Titan here, maybe.
Oh, that'll be awesome. Oh, I'd like that.
He has 6 mana.
I'd like to see that a lot.
Is he going to cast Grave Titan, or is he going to Ritual into Grizzlebrand? He's going to try and Ritual into Grizzlebrand, okay.
Cool. This is one of the ways to do it, isn't it?
Yes. I would. Okay, so he's going to force this, I would guess. If he doesn't, then that's quite the upset. You don't have. What's this, a Brainstorm? Okay, so he may not have the force that I thought he did have, which.
Are you a fan of him drawing those Brainstorm cards one by one?
I'm a fan of him drawing the first one. I think he should have Brainstormed in response to the Dark Ritual and tried to counter it, because it stops all of the discard apart from Collective Brutality, and it means he can't cast Grizzlebrand, so he doesn't have to use a Force of Will. And he would get to keep the Snapcaster Mage, which he could use on his Predict. But
oh, so you think he should use the counterbalance to...
Yeah, yeah, to counter the Dark Ritual, because he can't do anything after that.
Yeah. Tom Cadden is correct. Tom Brown is wearing a bloody stupid hat.
Tom Brown, I think it has that surgically attached to his head. It's very rare that he doesn't wear a hat.
He also just flashed his opponent a Terminus as he put it back.
Tom's playing a lot of his cards off screen, which is kind of awkward.
I'm going to have to...
What's that, a second counterbalance? That's a Search for Azkanto, I believe. It's got a new border.
Yep.
And yeah, that's it.
Right, while they're shuffling up...
So as expected, Tom took the game after resolving Jason counterbalance.
I'll go and tell them where the... Where
they
the
should move their cards down a bit as well.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. All right.
So, Tom's brought in Flusters and Surgicals, I would guess, and a Snapcaster Mage, and he didn't choose to bring in any Blasts, which is reasonable. I think having some number of Blasts over some of the white cards that you normally have to leave in is fine. You normally leave in some number of Swords to Plowshares because it is just quite good against the deck. But maybe cutting the last Terminus or something for a Blast, because Stuart has Show and Tell, I suspect, after showing Underground Sea, is good. I think you normally have to leave in a Terminus or something. Can't quite remember the sideboard map, but I think that's what it would be. Stuart, on the other hand, he might bring in something like Defense Grid or Pithing Needle. And he probably will bring in Show and Tell after showing us the blue.
So I told them where the side of the camera was and had a quick look at Stuart's sideboard.
Oh, right.
He's got 4 Show and Tells.
Shocking.
2 Ancient Tombs.
That's pretty good.
It's quite spicy. There's Inkwell Leviathan. There's a Dread of Night.
That'll come in,
there's
but okay.
There's a couple of Echoing Truths as well.
Interesting.
So there's a lot of nice things he's going to bring in. Collective Brutalities as well.
Does he have anything like Defense Grid or Pithing Needle?
A Pithing Needle.
He has a Pithing Needle. Okay. Yes. So Tom didn't bring in the Blasts.
Okay.
He brought in his Surgicals, his Snapcaster Mage, and his Flusser Storms.
No Monastery Mentors.
I don't think he did bring in any Mentors, no.
It's quite greedy.
Yes. Well,
I'm going to counter everything.
You win with Jace.
Yes, but not quickly.
No, I think Mentor is probably better than the single Entreat.
I would say so, yeah.
There's a downside of bringing in a Mentor in that your opponent can thought seize it and reanimate it. Which has happened to me.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's quite a corner case.
Normally you end up leaving in the last Terminus. He could cut that for a Blast, which I think would be right, because he's seen Underground Sea and Terminus isn't that good.
And you're on the draw here, so you need to be having things like
cheap
Mentor to get in there.
Mentor.
To be aggressive.
Yeah.
Plus, Stuart's bringing in Dread Knight, so I'd like to see him bring in Mentor and get blown out.
Is Stuart bringing in Dread of Night?
Possibly, yeah.
I don't think he should.
Well, he's expecting a Mentor, isn't he?
It's not the game he wants to play.
No, I know.
Stuart should be playing the game of I would like Grizzlebrand and play. Not
well, the turn one show and tell is on here, isn't it? There's Lotus Petals,
and ancient
Dark
tombs.
Rituals, Ancient Tombs. It's going to be good. And hopefully we'll be able to see their graveyards. I think they both put them in the right place this time. Oh, the games. Yeah. Sorry.
Yes. Okay. We're never going to get invited back. We keep forgetting to do the same thing. There we go.
There we are. Well, luckily they're still sideboarding, so no harm done. What does chat think of the grandmother's carpet on the left there?
I believe that was a MKM thing. Tom Cadden, Black Red, we believe, is bringing in Show and Tells, Ancient Tombs.
It's bringing in blue cards.
Yes.
But the classic Black Red deck would bring in Stronghold Gambit.
Or Stronghold Gambit. I forgot about that card.
It's probably worth bringing up.
Yes. One word, fit. That's a... Yeah? Nick Fit?
No, he's talking about the grandma's mat.
Right.
So Stronghold Gambit is your...
That's a terrible resolution image.
It is. It's your red show and tell. So you each choose a card from your hand, which is a creature. And the lowest mana cost one gets to put it down.
So if your opponent doesn't have any creatures, you get your Grizzlebrand.
It's wonderful, usually, yeah. And you can get everything out with this card. It's pretty good. Oh, he's flashed the Mentor. So Tom did bring in the Mentor.
Yeah, I didn't see him doing that. So he has been playing around with his cards a lot, though.
He dropped it on the table.
Ooh, maybe Stuart will bring in his Shadow Knight now.
Fred, it's a little bit late for that.
Oh. Cosmic Ally says spicy. Yeah, it is a red card, so...
So Tom's got a counterbalance in his opener, Brainstorm and a Force. You're a bit chilly, Francis.
I am a bit cold.
Put your coat on. Stay warm. Don't catch a chill.
It looks like a Weatherspoon rug. Yeah, it does look a bit like a spoon.
Yeah.
Lots of marks to hide the food on the floor.
Unfortunately, Stuart's mulliganing here, which obviously isn't something he wants to do, but not against the counterspell deck, because he's likely to keep a fast turn one, and you want to have something a little bit of backup.
Yes, I mean, if Tom doesn't have Force or Surgical,
Tom has Force.
Well, I think you want to be mulliganing aggressively. What do we think of four color loam in the current metagame?
I rather like the deck.
I like that it's a deck.
Do you not think it's good? It's good against miracles.
The card Chalice of the Void is good against miracles.
Abrupt Decay is good against miracles.
I don't think that's true.
I mean, it's good against new miracles, isn't it? We should talk about this match and then discuss it. Yeah, because you're back to counterbalances, aren't you? And there's the Inkwell Leviathan. Wonderful.
So he resolved his turn one, put Lotus my thing Petal in the graveyard. Interesting that Tom didn't force Faithless Looting there.
Well, he's going to force the reanimate spell, isn't he?
I don't like that. He might have Surgical. Dark Sphere is the name of the shop.
It is, yeah.
Reanimate my turn one Inkwell. Interesting that he brought an Inkwell Leviathan.
Well, it doesn't have to plow. Seems like a, or Jace. It seems like a good
yeah,
place to be.
Yeah, it does do those things. But it does also...
Also can't be blocked by angels.
I think it's wrong that Tom is forcing this here. I think he should have forced the Faithless Looting.
Yeah, because you have more ways of getting things out of the yard than putting them in this deck.
Mm-hmm. And Faithless Looting draws two cards.
It does, yeah. You're all about the value, aren't you, Francis? All about value.
Magic is about value. Oh, look, more Faithless Looting. Okay, so maybe I was proven wrong, but I still don't think that should matter.
No, there's correct plays and there's incorrect plays.
Also, Tom got rid of his counterbalance.
So back to aggro alone.
It'd be great to see you, Romario. Pitching show and tell, showing the tech.
He's hidden it though under the Clepto brutality, just so Tom forgets.
Oh yeah, yeah, doesn't he? What a sneaky move by Stuart. It might well be that Tom has another counterbalance here.
No, his hand was Brainstorm and some lands.
Oh.
Would you have discarded the Brainstorm to the Force? Exiled.
Somebody's singing. Right. No, I would have kept the Brainstorm.
Okay, fair enough. We don't work here. I don't know, Sam. Anyway, back to the game. I don't know, I feel like I can't really say anything. It's all, the world has just crushed me as a Coke drinking hobo has come and asked to buy.
Whoa.
What?
Hmm? It really is your granny's carpet against the ultra sexy London Eternal pulling magnet.
Yeah, because you know, if you're an eligible young man and or you're a single lady out there.
Oh yeah, my bedspread is the London Eternal match.
Legacy is where you want to be to pick up a.
Look at all the chicks in the Legacy tournament.
Well, no, I was going to say why don't ladies come down and pick up some of these eligible men? For Magic players though, they probably are the most eligible. They can afford the decks, so.
Yeah, then most of them are solvent if they can spend lots of money on underground seas.
That's or maybe they're not solvent.
Because they spent money on underground seas. Yeah.
That's a £300 card now, plus. £300 plus.
Underground Sea, yep.
I was thinking about this actually today, talking to a friend. The mana base for a bug deck is £2,000. Just the fetch, just the jewels. It's becoming absurd. Not that it wasn't already, but, you know. It's becoming madder and madder. So the Thought Seize has taken the counterbalance, and Tom found a second one. I think Stuart's been a bit unlucky on his draws here. He kept a very fast hand, like
he did Mulligan.
Like said he's going to, yep. And then you just go do it straight away, mate. Go for it.
Another looting. Yeah, I'm gonna cast it. And yeah.
Exactly, M. Solace. Live on the street, but you've got the base.
Tom B is not eligible anymore, but can say that the London Eternal is defo a pulling magnet.
Oh,
who is Cosmic Ally?
Well, they're a big fan of Mr. Brown, I think. Don't know who that could be.
That's just a little suspicious comment there.
It is, isn't it?
Might ask Tom Brown if he knows who Cosmic Ally is.
Scars of Mirrodin. No, it's moved to a different place since Scars of Mirrodin pre-release. Darksphere was then opposite the London Eye, next to the Waterloo Tube
really?
Station. It was, yeah. It was next to a shop that sold balloons or something, and there was some kind of...
Like right on the river?
Yeah, right on the river, yeah.
Wow. Right.
Next to the one of that chicken shop that was viewed by the chicken connoisseur.
I don't remember
in
that.
Waterloo. Anyway, don't know anything about that. But now it's in.
Oh, there.
There, yeah.
Right. Okay.
Now we're under the under the railway arches, in a very very big room. Space probably for. What would you guess? 100? 70?
Yeah,
80?
Tom said 120 in there. That might be possible.
It'd be a bit squeezy.
Bit of a push at 120, but yeah, 100 or so. So, Miracles is casting cantrips, and at this point, it's quite difficult for Stuart to do anything.
Yeah.
As his deck has a lot of cards that don't do anything in this position. And Tom has a counterbalance, and he's casting a Predict or something here. Yep. And he's choosing to get rid of a Snapcaster Mage, which is one of the better cards in the matchup. So, I'm... I think it's interesting. That means that his card must be really good.
It's hard to disagree with what's going on, though, because you can't see his hand. He shuffles it so quickly.
He has a Mentor, a Force, a Surgical.
Is that a Surgical? I thought that might have been an Arid Mesa.
I think there's a black card in his hand.
That's a lovely position to be in, isn't it?
Yeah, that's definitely
Surgical. When you know you've won the game.
Well, yeah, I mean...
So, we should talk about aggro alone. Current meta. What do you think?
It's fine.
Hmm?
I think that Mox Diamond is a pretty silly Magic card.
Oh, it's a great card, isn't it?
Aggro Lumen players always seem to have their turn one Mox Diamonds.
They do, and that turn one bomb is really good.
But, yeah. If it doesn't do that, then it tends to be rather anemic, in my opinion. The deck doesn't seem to do anything after that. It's just like a bad mid-range deck. You just, I'll play my Dark Confidant, which is just sort of slightly below power level.
You think Dark Confidant, you know, God, it's a sad, sad state of affairs when Dark Confidant is slightly below power level, but you're probably
I'll
right.
I'll play my Knight of the Reliquary. Yeah, as a Miracles player, that from that deck, I can ignore Dark Confidant for four turns.
Yeah, I know.
They're not drawing him to Turok and Bloodbred Elves, they're drawing lands.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah, they're getting, like they're getting their value that way. Maybe it's against Miracles, but maybe try not to see it from purely your own perspective. Francis,
well, I suppose that's the main one. I used to play Delver a lot. It was quite scary then.
Yeah.
Punishing Fire.
Yeah.
That card is really good in Legacy. That's a reason to play the deck, I suppose.
Liliana's probably not as good as it used to be.
No. Well, Young Pyromancer does a lot to fight that.
Possibly worth trying maybe a new Liliana.
That card's really good. I think the deck has a space.
I think it's probably an enjoyable deck to play, actually.
Yes, I think that's the main reason that I would play it.
Mm.
But that's a good reason.
You have to play Chalices to kind of compete, which is a little bit of a shame, really.
That's fine.
No, but do you know what I mean? You know, that's the state of affairs a lot of the time now in Legacy. And there's a Chancellor of the Annex going to the bin. I think Tom is not going to let Stuart resolve anything relevant here.
No, I think Tom has won. As we predicted he would.
Foreshadowing.
I mean, what do you think Tom's going to lose? Tom needs to play slower on stream. I know from playing him he plays so fast that he's resolving spells two after the one you're thinking about forcing.
Yes, he plays overly quick. I'd agree there.
Diego was on the play and he played his turn one Chalice off Mox Diamond. Alice was about to get his first turn Mana Bond of the day. Yes. I was actually sat next to them playing my match when they were playing that match.
Yeah. Yeah. So here we are. This is the show and tell. And here's the predict or Snapcaster Brainstorm.
But I was playing this deck. So.
Okay. So you had to concentrate on what you were doing.
Yeah. I think I was playing versus Check Pile.
Oh, okay.
Force of Will.
Force on top.
I suppose this is a way that...
I'm kind of thinking that Stuart might not have anything to
yeah,
actually show.
Yeah, I think Stuart is baiting something. Yeah. Cool. Ooh.
Yeah, pay for it. Oh, I like this. Oh, yes.
Save it.
There's the force.
Oh.
Poo.
Tom, aggro handshakes.
Aggro GG handshake there. Oh, some people, no manners. No, I'm all right, thank you.
Thank you.
So that was a quick round. How long was that match? We should see if we're going to have anyone else on stream. Maybe something slightly less lopsided.
Ethan. Away.
Yeah.
Is there anyone else still playing?
I think this looks like everyone's done, so we should head back to the booth.
Let's go. Let's go back to the booth with Rich Hagar.
Yeah, but you'll give Tom his second win. Alex will be very annoyed if we don't.
All right. There you go.
Have you pressed save? Yeah.
I did. Good. Right, back to the booth.
Rich Hagen isn't... shall I be Rich and you can be Riley?
I'm Riley Knight.
I'll make some terrible puns.
All the lovely ladies love me. I'm a very handsome man.
We've got an actual Aussie here.
Yeah, you could pretend to be Riley Knight, couldn't you? Right, well, thank you very much for participating in our chat about Black, Red and Miracles.
Are you shuffling cards, Francis?
Of course I am.
You've actually got twitches. This is awful.
Ooh.
It's all right, we won't ask him back.
Anyway, thank you very much. I believe the round is sort of ending.
We're petering out by the look of it.
And so I think without much further ado.
Miko versus Callum might go to a third game, but probably we've seen both decks already.
Shall I go and check?
Yeah, I might just find out.
Callum? 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 You're in game two or three? Game two or three? Oh, you're practicing. Oh, fucker.
Yeah, I think
yeah,
we're done.
Yeah, we're all done. We're all done. There's nothing going on here.
There was some high tide on stream at some point, Mirage Swamp, so...
Yeah, you can come back and watch it.
A Tomcat and Liliana of the False Hope. Not a magic card, but...
Is Liliana of the minus
the last hope.
1/2/1.
Liliana of the minus 2/1. Yeah, that's a good name by Wizards. Anyway, thank you very much for tuning in. I hope you enjoy watching the high tide replays. We'll be back next week with more Legacy on a Tuesday with probably some different people.
Yes,
doing this bit.
Well, I'm going to play Lands next week, so maybe I'll go on stream and we can actually see that being played.
We might actually play each other on stream.
That'll be a good match.
Maybe. I might lose. It'd be bad.
Well, I might lose, but it would be interactive and fun, possibly.
Probably. All right. Well, thank you very much for tuning in.
Well, I've been Tom.
I've been Francis. And see you next week.
Bye.